Getting a pint at the pub today, it sure does take a lot. And 900 bars at £4.50 costs a fucking lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? Sometimes you wanna drink in every pub in Brighton town. From where the spoons to Jumbo Lounge. Checking the map at the dog track, from the lobster to the fucking cow. We're gonna drink in every pub in town. We're having a smoke at the County Oak, the jolly drinking of beer. The infinite crawl bring boozing to your ears.
Cheers.
Cheers, man. Cheers.
Hello.
Hello, episode 2.
Welcome back to Tonight with Bob and Joe, the infinite pub crawl, yeah. Is it?
On the road.
On the road.
The road, the radio road show, not BBC stars.
Well, I think as the episodes go on, we'll come up with a more concise title for what these things are. But I think infinite pub crawl, that's what the map's called. That's the Google map.
Yeah, that's the map.
So far, we've managed to get to 5 pubs, yeah. I believe.
Eventually, so, we'll start putting that map up. So
yeah, so people can, you can join us if you wanted to. You could replicate our journey.
Read
actually, on the map at the moment, I'll show you later on, but you can actually see the way we've walked. I've put little walking lines.
So
I'm hoping by the end of it, we'll have drawn some giant phallus on the map of Brighton or something, by the directions we walk in.
A huge boom. a blue-titted booby.
Absolutely. If we could draw a whole booby
blue-footed
across the map.
Yeah. Blue-titted.
Well, I'm sure they got a bit of both, haven't they?
What are you drinking, man?
We're drinking Kronenbourg. Yeah. It was only 20p more than Amstel, which, to be honest, Amstel, not to insult the drink, but it's never been my favourite.
Yeah, you don't
lager.
Like it. I don't mind it, but 360...
Was it? No. This wasn't 360.
460.
460. Yeah.
460.
Which, just to say, although it wasn't officially as part of the pub crawl, yet last night I was at the goddamn... Is it Prince George? The one that's opposite the Great Eastern?
Yeah, man.
And, you know, it's like a vegan, vegetarian
the
place.
It is sweet... nachos there.
Yeah. I saw. Yeah, but fucking hell, £4.90 a pint. I was literally like, I sort of did a big inhale, and the bar staff was like, I know, yeah. You know, and I just thought, well, why is it that much? Yeah, it was Foster's.
Yeah,
and I thought, why is it that much? Yeah. And I thought, is it because, I mean, kind of a nice atmosphere. They had a nice garden. You know, one day we'll review the place, but yeah. But you know, I just can't work out why it's that much.
Neither can I. I don't know what, but it's something to do with the dying trade. I don't know, man. It's scary because the more that happens, the less people go to pubs, the more they shut down.
Well, it's interesting because I don't know if I mentioned this as the last episode, actually, because we were pretty hammered by the end of it. But when I was researching pubs to put on the map, I ended up realising that a lot of the ones I was adding, like a huge amount of the pubs I was adding to the list, just didn't exist anymore.
Yeah, the notes are not there.
Some of them had transformed into hotels or changed into different bars, different names, but most of them had gone.
That's a good point. Where are we?
We are right now at the Station Hotel, which actually is a pub.
Yeah, it's a Victorian pub too. I think...
mostly.
I think 1894.
Wow. Did you know that? I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's on the sign outside.
Today I haven't done any research into the pubs.
Excellent.
Yeah, I guess a bit more. Well, maybe we can ask. We can sort of do a bit of a Mulder and Scully.
Yeah, you've got to ask.
Try to investigate.
Cool. I think because you've got longer hair, you're Scully.
Fair enough. I'm all right with that.
Yeah, but
I'm
in reality, you're probably Mulder. So, actually, on the topic of Mulder and Scully, man, do you remember Catatonia's Mulder and Scully song?
No, what were we talking about? Didn't it keep following us around wherever we were?
That might have been Road Rage.
Oh, was it Road Rage?
Catatonia's other 90s banger. That was their number one, I think.
Yeah, like every pub we went in, it kept playing. Was that last time?
I think so, yeah.
That's fucking weird.
Yeah, the music in there wasn't any good. But anyway, this song, I don't know if... This is quite a bold thing to say, but 2 days ago, I was in the kitchen. I was working in the kitchen, and I just thought about this song, Mulder and Scully, because I've been watching a lot.
Of course, yeah.
Season 6.
Is it actually called Mulder and Scully, the song? The
song's called Mulder and Scully.
So it's almost like an official X-Files track.
Yeah, yeah, and the official video for it has pseudo Mulder and Scullys doing things in it.
Oh, wow, it's a shame they couldn't have actually got fucking...
I know. I think now they could have got them, because I think they... Like Duchovny, and they clearly heard it.
Oh, of course.
They clearly think, yeah.
Duchovny's got it on the car radio every fucking day.
Absolutely. I'll tell you something. I'm pretty sure it might be the best pop record of all time. It's one of my... It's nice. One of the best songs ever.
Wow.
I fucking love it.
I don't even know if I've... Oh, no, maybe I have heard it. Maybe you did play it for me.
The chorus goes, this could be... things are getting strange. I'm starting to worry. This could be a case for Mulder and Scully.
Oh, yeah. This rings a bell.
Right?
Yeah.
But the verses...
So are they using the metaphor of the X-Files to talk about a relationship?
It's along those lines. Ooh, yeah, they're talking about how paranormal the relationship that she's talking about is getting so bloody weird. It's like... We need the X-Files in here to sort it out.
That's beautiful.
That's exactly the
kind of song that I would want to write.
There's some great lines in it. The first line is, I'd rather be liberated, I find myself captivated. Nice. Stop doing what you keep doing.
Nice, nice.
It's just very good.
That feels like a Spyro bot.
Yeah, it does. And near the end, they've got the best line in it is probably, and as for some happy ending, I'd rather stay single and thin.
Ooh. That rings a bell.
The way she executes it, you're just like, oh man, catatonia. I don't know if you know, I've done research on catatonia for...
Catatonia?
Yeah, catatonia is a state of mania.
Oh shit.
To do with something specific, I can't remember what.
But if you're catatonically drunk, that means that you've just drunk so much, paralytic.
You've been listening to so much catatonia and drinking so much. They've got another song called I Am The Mob.
I Am The Mob.
Yeah, that one's really good as well. They've got like a line there, the bridge goes, one for the money, two for the money, three for the money, am I an Easter Bunny, come on.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, it's really great.
I just wanted to apologise, I realised I was jogging my leg then, and it might have been clicking the microphone, which is, I'm going to stop that now. Last episode, two main errors happened. The first thing was the first pub we went into, the County Oak.
Yeah.
That was the first time we ever used the microphone.
Yeah.
We didn't realise that if you move or toggle the wire, it goes... This horrible wave. So we're not doing that anymore. And I think the rest of the recordings turned out all right, didn't they? For the most part.
We also missed out the second pub there.
Because, the Long Man of Wilmington.
Yeah.
We kept pausing the recording instead of actually saving it as a separate file. So we corrupted the whole fucking thing.
Yeah, 33 minutes, no megabytes.
Which is really sad because there were some great little conversations we had there about birds and stuff.
So that will be a special... we'll go back there.
We're going to go back there, hopefully with Filthy Owl, because there's a dartboard.
Yeah.
I think that's always... If there's any good excuse to bring Alex anywhere,
it'll be a dartboard.
But sorry, back to catatonia songs.
No, I mean, they're just brilliant. If, like, you know, back in the old days, Tonight with Bob and Joe, we would have just played it and let everyone decide.
I know.
So, you know, if you want to listen to it,
just YouTube it
and listen to it. It's excellent.
Shall we briefly just talk about the pub?
Yeah, I suppose you should do.
It's really nice, isn't it?
Yeah, it's ace.
I've been here once before. Have you ever been here?
No, never been here. Didn't know it existed. I knew there was a pub around here, but I didn't know this actual thing existed.
We actually had to, like, go through the tunnel in the middle of...
That's the train.
Oh, that's the train, if you can hear it.
Yeah, so we're right next to Preston Park Station.
A true field recording.
Yeah.
But yeah, we had to go through the station in order to get here, so it's a bit of an adventure up the top of the hill. They were just telling me, the barman was telling me, this pub has a pub cat. That used to be here when the last owners ran it, and he used to sleep on the bar and stuff.
Oh, right.
But because they left, the cat's now astray, but they're not allowed to let it in.
Oh, that's fucked.
I know. And because people might have allergies to cat hair, and it interferes with the kitchen.
I'm not into that, because I know for a fact that there's a pub on the journey on the way back in that has a cat in it. And also,
and it also has food, does it?
Yeah, yeah. Mm. And I also walked past a pub earlier, Alice pointed it out. She said, oh, that's a funny sign. I can't remember, but the sign said... I think it was a Heart and Hand.
That cat's famous, man. That cat's on YouTube and stuff. Yeah.
It's a famous cat, and it says on the board outside quite brashly, come inside and play with our pussy.
Brilliant, brilliant. It also says no dogs. It says no dogs, doesn't it, as well? That's the reason why it's a no dog pub.
Yeah, sure.
Pardon me.
That's fair enough.
That pub's pretty chilled out. We'll go there one day, but we are slowly, it feels, worming into town from the direction we're moving
into. It does feel like it.
We can try to avoid that, so we kind of... You know, like getting the broccoli on the side of the plate before we get to our steak.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, I don't know why I always end up with vegetable.
It's always vegetable stuff with you. It's always meat and vegetables being together or not together.
Yeah, that's very true.
I don't know which way we want to go. We'll see.
Yeah,
right?
But see like, what will happen. Destiny takes us.
Because we could go down this sort of down this way, end up going past Crown and Anchor and the Preston.
Yeah, I think we might as well. Might as well.
And then we could go up to like the park view.
But is the park view open or is it?
It isn't.
It
no, but we could go past it and up to Pingleberry.
I think we shouldn't do that. I think the reason why is because if the park view is still closed, we'll have a look. Mm. But if it is still closed, we could save that whole area for another day. and just come back around, because you've got the Hollingbury, you've got the jolly, the new jolly, which, to be honest, I'm not super excited about going back to, all those kind of ones. So we could save that.
We could take our own vinyls to that one, though, if they insist on being that kind of place.
We'll God.
Take a load of... that new Tom Waits.
I think that might be, if we were to go there soon, that would be the first pub where it has to be a half pint.
Well, the Crown and Anchor has to be a half.
Oh, definitely. That's actually, no, sorry. The Crown and Anchor has. We'll talk more about the Crown and Anchor when we get there.
Might be the next pub.
But might be the next pub. No, yeah, it is actually. You're right.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, you're right.
We'll only be there for a couple of minutes.
Yeah, fucking hell. Just drink up, because it's a fucking shithole.
Yeah.
Not physically, but anyway.
Yeah, it's pretty gorgeous.
But let's talk more about this pub briefly. Got lots of board games, nice atmosphere inside. The barman was amazingly friendly.
Very cool guy.
I even made a point of actually saying to him, like, you know, you're super friendly, especially in comparison to what I got earlier.
Yeah, he's a lovely bloke. I could drink here for a long time. It's clean. The bathroom facilities are fantastic.
They are really nice. Yeah. And it's a really nice garden. They've got two gardens. They've got one out the front, which is really nice as well.
That one's probably caught the sun, though.
It's just got a very... It's got a nice old-time feel. It's not like... It's like a no-nonsense pub.
Yeah.
I just dig it. I'd come back here if I was ever in the area, definitely.
Without a doubt. Yeah, without a doubt. Price is fine,
absolutely. I just... it's a good, nice pub to start off the day with. You know, start off the
what
episode.
What time is it? It's about 2.
I think it is... Oh, no, I think it's later than that, man.
Oh, nice. We're on about 3:30. It's a good time to start a crawl.
Absolutely, yeah, because it could be, you know, fucking hell.
Wonder how many we'll get today. 5, 6? What do you think?
I think we'll be pushing it for 6, but we'll see. We'll see.
Yeah.
Shall we call a time? Yeah? Until the next...
Yeah, time. There we go. See you guys at the next pub.
Cheers.
Cheers, man.
What are we drinking?
We are drinking halves. I'll say it again, halves.
Yeah, we're drinking halves.
Bravo. That's got something to do with the pub. We mentioned it a minute ago. We're at the Crown and Anchor.
The Crown and Anchor, which is that's a fucking beautiful name for a pub. Really doesn't represent what it's like at all.
No.
It doesn't feel like a sailor's or a fisherman's place. Maybe one day it was. I don't know how old this place is, but maybe
so it's a bit. It's someday. Also a little bit too far away from the sea to have anything to do with a fisherman.
That's true, yeah. It's not near the beach.
Yeah.
God knows. God
it's
knows.
Like a strange mashup of a pub over here. So it looks quite brilliant, really. It's very black. It's got loads of black
chandelier
everywhere.
Yeah.
There's a chandelier. It's kind of high budget. There's dudes in suits. Like
there used to be taxidermy here, but I think they've taken it away now.
So that's testament to what's happened to
them. Yeah,
yeah,
true.
If they've taken the taxidermy away, then they're not in a good place spiritually.
I agree. So what happened earlier is I was waiting for Joe just before we started the podcast, and I came in with a little coffee, with a little double espresso from around the corner, because if you're going to drink coffee anywhere, you know, unless you're in a Wetherspoons and you're just trying to get cheap coffee, it's better to get coffee from an actual coffee house than bring it to the pub, right? That makes sense.
Yeah, definitely.
But because I didn't have a drink at the time, and listeners, if I'm wrong about this, send us an email and explain, like, you know, tonightwithpodcast@gmail.com. Tell us if I'm being a dick here and if I'm in the wrong, but... We're drinking a fucking double espresso, using the Wi-Fi. The lady said it was fine. 5 minutes in, the fucking landlord comes in. He's like, mate, are you waiting for someone? I was like, yeah, actually I am. And he was like, because you're not actually allowed to drink any other drinks in here. Do you realise that? And I was like, it's a coffee, mate, and I'm going to get a half, all right? And he was sort of looked at me with the eyes of some fucking rabid bulldog. And then fucking walked away, and I just thought,
that's fucking bullshit.
And it's funny because on the last episode, where although we didn't record it, we basically ended up coming here just for 3 seconds to see if it was open, and they were dicks to us then well.
They weren't just like, no, sorry, lads are closed. They were dicks.
Mm.
They really, because the other place actually that's next door that we'll go to in a minute.
Just so much
friendlier. We went in there and they were like, oh, they really were like, oh, sorry, lads, no, we've called time. And we're like, oh, no worries. And they're like, next time, boys.
Yeah.
You know, real fun type, you know, just, you've missed the mark. If you were drinking in here 20 minutes before time, you'd be able to drink for another hour.
Because the thing is, I totally understand. If I was bringing in my own fucking Galahads, if I was bringing in my own beers, I totally get that. But a coffee in a small coffee cup, I'm not smuggling in whiskey. I'm not trying to make you lose business. The guy was bothered because I hadn't bought anything. But you know what? The best way of putting customers off, the best way of pushing them away and not buying a drink is by fucking, you know, is by being like that.
Being really rude.
And in fact, the only reason I did it is because I knew we had to come back here later.
Yeah.
And because we have to come back here later, I thought, right, I don't want to create a bad precedent, because I could have just walked out and been like, fuck you.
Yeah, yeah.
But I wasn't going to be like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Basically, we keep saying it. We said it, I don't know if we said it last episode, but we were certainly saying it a lot that day. You catch more flies with honey. You've got to butter up your customers.
Butter up your toast, man.
You know, let's talk about the garden where we are now.
Well, actually, I am sat in the sun, so we're talking about a good spot for sun at 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
I'm sat in the shade, so it's kind of like a two-face of tables.
Yeah.
We both get what we want.
Yeah.
It's a sports bar garden, isn't it?
It's AstroTurf, there's picnic tables, but there's also those sort of plastic woven, you know, the plastic woven picnic table type things.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and they've got like little cushions on them. They're a bit crap.
There's also a really creepy, you'll see it, if you're watching on YouTube, you'll see the listening watching on YouTube, Fusion, you'll see the pink scary house that we're posing outside in the photograph.
Yeah.
It's for children.
To play area.
But there's something eerie about
it. In the interest of safety, children must be supervised at all times beyond this point.
Yeah.
So it's really quite a creepy place.
Do you think they have a supervisor just watching from the corner, like a really creepy hunchback?
What I noticed inside, there's like loads of children's graffiti inside. So it's just really great work.
One of the bits of graffiti, what does it say?
Well, it's a Star of David.
And then it says...
And then it says exposed next
exposed.
To it. A child did not write that.
Unless the child's a massive conspiracy nut.
Yeah,
sort of,
He's like
anti-Zeitgeist.
He's into the Zionists.
Zionists.
He's been watching... Wait, his dad's well into YouTube.
He's like, watch this, son, with your cereal. Watch one of these fucking Jews did 9/11.
It was Mel Gibson and his son.
There's also a really creepy, very dark room, which I assume, which is kind of a semi-indoor, semi-outdoor, so I guess you can smoke in there. Maybe you can, maybe you can't.
Oh, yeah, you could smoke in that bit, yeah.
And it's kind of like a half, and I guess it's for when it rains.
Yeah.
But right now, with the lights off, it just looks like a really creepy kind of...
Yeah, the barmaid's actually coming round.
Barmaid's coming round. Okay, so we can't talk openly about how shit this place is.
Yeah, we can, definitely.
Okay.
Well, trash it.
I don't know. All I'm trying to say is
they've got a bit that's kind of like, Bob, you...
That scared me, that sound.
You put it properly when you... So when you first walk into the pub, it's got lots of black paint everywhere. It's got a kind of high... When you're in London and you go to these pubs sort of in the centre of London and they're like £6 a pint, it's got that kind of feel.
Yeah, and fucking loud club music.
Loud club music.
In the middle, not even aside from this crazy banging, just super loud club music. Now, a pub where this is, in the middle of nowhere in Brighton, Preston Park, it shouldn't be playing blaring fucking disco in the middle of the day.
Insane.
And there's one other pub that I've experienced that's like that, which is the Garden Pub, which is up near Port Said, we'll go to eventually.
Yeah.
And that was playing at like 2 p.m, fucking blaring, super loud club music.
I like the Station Pub that's up in Port Said.
There you go. Yeah. We'll go there again. That's also where, Brad Pitt used to fucking live, you know, bloody Diamond Geezer. He used to live there.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, yeah.
Meaden.
He used to live upstairs and work in the bar. James Meaden, that's right.
Brilliant guy.
If you're listening, James, we still remember you.
Yeah.
That's a nice pub. But there's only one other pub where I've experienced that. Middle of the day disco music. I know I sound like an old man.
No, you don't sound like an old man.
I do. I sound like I'm like, what are the kids doing these days listening to the disco? But it's like...
There's no children in there. There's
exactly.
No kids. It's not the client.
In the middle of the day, you come in for a quiet pint.
That's what I'm saying. It's strange. It's strange suits
that
are going in there. Mm. It's like the high budget. I keep saying high budget, but I don't really mean high budget.
No.
It's tacky.
It's like
cool,
mediocre budget, yeah.
Yeah, it's gross. They've got, as you walk through the pub, on the right, you've got a glass cabinet that should hold some sort of...
Trophy.
Yeah, some sort
dartboard
of pool
trophy.
Or dartboard trophies, but what it does hold is a makeshift tuck shop.
It's creepy, isn't it?
Bonbons.
And I was just
creepy,
saying,
yes.
the reason for it
they're
is
not
to
even
try
in
to...
like they're not even like in great Kilner jars or something. If you, they're not even
they're just plastic
in these horrible little plastic sort of happy shopper type.
The kind of thing that you keep sticking sex
kind of like,
in.
Boove d'air.
Yeah,
rest in peace. And then we've got a it just says on it like tuck shop, ask at bar, and you think. Who?
Yeah.
It's gonna. That's for the kids.
Yeah.
I've just got that.
Right. Of course. Yeah.
But
see, that's
it's
the thing.
Not advertised for the kids.
You know, I'm not saying that pubs shouldn't have, things for children. I'm also not saying that I don't. You know, I'm not saying that kids shouldn't be in pubs. I understand parents need a bit of a break every now and again. They need a bit of a drink.
If you had children, you don't bring them here.
I don't know. There's a weird vibe to it, man. Yeah.
I've got nieces and nephews. My brother and sister. My brother lives over in Port Slade. I think he goes to the Stone House along Port Slade.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah. I think he goes there quite a lot. That's like a real pub friendly, children everywhere on a Sunday type place.
I just finished my drink.
Yeah. That's all right. Do you want to call? I'll buy you a swig or two.
No.
Like that place has that place has, like, it's quite hectic. If you're not there with children, then it's a bit hectic, but that's fine. I mean, one happens to most people eventually having children, so that's the type of place you could go. But here, it doesn't even scream out that children ever come here.
Yeah, I know. There's a weirdly abandoned kind of feel, even to the pink.
It's like, what's the story? The Ballymorey's been abandoned.
Yeah, yeah, like that.
We're all spewing black tar showing around.
That's brilliant. That's brilliant. But yeah, I don't know. I've come here a couple of times, never had a really good time. I imagine when it's you know, in full swing on a Friday night, it's probably a bit more fun. I see now that Joe is analysing his half point as if there's something fucked up in there.
Yeah, there's bits in it.
Oh, for God's sake. I mean, to add insult to injury.
Can't drink these bits? I mean, there's bits in it.
To be fair, it's testament to the last episode, though, that we didn't really have a problem with any of the pubs that we were in. And that this is, in episode two, this is the first pub that we've come to where we're like, we don't like it.
Yeah.
And I think that goes to show that there are some pretty fucking great pubs in Brighton.
Yeah, yeah.
And especially on the edges, in the sticks, which is where we still are. We are still very much in the sticks.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, we're closer to town now than we were in episode one, but nonetheless. Just to also let the audience know, what we've developed is we're going to always start where we last left off on the map. So it's actually like a kind of real crawl. We might break that rule at some point. But for now, it feels like quite a nice way, so you can actually see us connecting to the place.
Yeah, that's right. Also, I'm going to try something pretty abrupt here.
Okay, no worries.
I'm going to try it out. Uh-huh. Actually, I don't know your...
Oh, yeah, sure. Sorry, I'll just go into my phone.
Try that out.
Secret passcode.
Hopefully we're not clicking around too much with the movements.
Yeah, 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 sure.
But I'm just going to go... on to
try not to
Safari.
Touch the thing on your sleeve.
Oh yeah, there we go. Cool. And so, what's the name of this place? Crown and Anchor.
Crown and Anchor. Yeah. Crown, you're trying to look for the bad reviews.
Anchor. I'm not going to look for any TripAdvisor.
Yeah, yeah. What we were talking about earlier is maybe, I don't know if we should do it in every pub or just pubs that we're a little bit suspicious of. But we're going to like read the worst reviews.
I'll tell you what. We'll read the next review when we get to the next pub because we finished our drinks here.
Yeah,
and
we finished
the Wi-Fi's crap.
We'll let you know what we think of this pub. In the next pub, and what everyone else thinks about it.
Yeah. Time at the bar.
Time.
Cheers, man.
Cheers.
Nice.
What are we drinking?
We're drinking Carling.
How much was it?
£3.15, man.
Amazing.
Incredible. Amazing. Yeah.
Really incredible. Good. That's cheaper than the Sportsman Stoneham affair.
Yeah.
Until 6 o'clock here as well. So it's from what, 12 till 6?
12 till 6, happy hour, Monday to Thursday.
That is a fucking outrageously good happy hour, man. That's so good.
I was here drinking the other day and it was about 6:20 as well. And I was
and
like,
still doing it?
Yeah, still giving you the good drink. You know,
that's just magic. You can tell immediately, actually, as soon as we just talked to the bar guy, he's so relaxed, chilled out, nice guy. So right now,
can we remember the name of this place?
The name of the... That's
can't, can
question.
We? We never remember the name of them.
Question.
It's called the Preston something.
I thought it was called the Golden Pump or something.
No, it's not called the Golden Pump. That sounds like a dream you've had.
I think it's called the... No, it's called the something tap. It's called the Preston Park tap.
The Preston Park Brewery tap.
Golden...
No, Golden.
Golden Pump.
The Golden Fleece.
Uncle Terry's Golden Pump.
It's called the Preston Park Brewery tap.
Yeah.
That's okay. What it's called.
I think it should be renamed Uncle Terry's Golden Pump. But
well, it's a good name for a pub.
But no, it's a sports pub, basically. That's what it is. We've got TV screens in every booth. We're sitting in one of those booths now.
And they'll put on whatever you want to watch.
That is brilliant.
Whether you want to watch the Nags, whether you want to watch the
Beagle. If there was a game that was on, but you needed to watch the Nags, they'll turn it on for you.
Yeah.
I mean, that's...
So they've got the big ones. They've got the cricket on up there. They've got the Nags on behind us. And then up here, anything else that's going.
I've seen people betting here as well. Like,
yeah, I was betting here.
Were you betting here?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, nice.
So Filthy Al came and met me in Al.
Yeah.
Down here. And, it was during the... The Nags from last month,
I can't remember. The nice Nags.
Cheltenham.
Yeah. It's kind of... I think
everyone was betting. We were all putting quids on. Even the landlady had money on Mr. Pete because her husband's called Pete and stuff.
Oh, I love that. I think it's kind of interesting, quite nice day call. There's like a big open kind of greenhouse light window letting in a lot of natural daylight. There's a kind of... slightly contemporary looking candelabra of wires and upcycled lampshades.
Yeah, yeah.
Which looks kind of cool.
Two dartboards,
yeah, that's an amazing thing unto itself.
Pool table as well.
Got some taxidermy.
Yeah. Never see pool tables. It's so hard to find a pool table.
Yeah, yeah, there you go.
There's one here.
I'm pretty sure it's a 50p.
I just think the vibe of this place is really nice.
Yeah.
You know, it's so funny, isn't it? Isn't it weird that, like, I mean, obviously I'm not really trying to include Wetherspoons within this, but that the places where the pints are the cheapest also turn out to be the places where they're more relaxed and people are nicer to you.
People are nicer, yeah.
Interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Interesting that you pay more for a worse experience.
It's strange, isn't it? I suppose when you're paying more for that kind of experience, you're paying to prop up sort of a mirage.
Yeah.
It's like people are walking through deserts,
yeah,
social deserts.
Looking for the oasis.
Nothing. And, yeah, and so they just make them up in their heads, and everyone just props up the mistaken reality and goes, great, yeah, pay us loads.
It's like that voice.
Here you can pretend you're having a great time.
Exactly. It's like that voice documentary where the guy builds the restaurant in his shed and he gets everyone to go there.
Yeah.
And, you know, through tricking TripAdvisor and stuff that.
TripAdvisor, let's do the TripAdvisor.
Oh, yeah, yeah, so we've got some bad reviews up from the last pub.
That guy's great. What's that guy called again?
I can't remember. He's like, he's kind of voice's darling, isn't he?
Yeah, he's really funny, man. He's a really funny guy. You know, his first writing gigs were... That's how he ended up doing what he did. It's because his first writing gigs were paid TripAdvisor reviews.
Oh, wow, of course. Wow, so he just, like, he fakes them.
Yeah, yeah, he gets paid by a company to fake reviews for whoever he's been told
shocking,
to fake.
That's shocking, the whole game's rigged.
Well, that's...
That doesn't surprise me.
No, but that's why he did...
Of course, to point it out.
To point out how rigged it is. If he gets people to write reviews of his fake restaurant, we can get it to the number one restaurant in London.
Yeah, it's great, isn't it?
You know, and it didn't exist, did it?
No, well, it did in the end, and he microwaved food.
He made it exist, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he made it.
And everyone
it real.
Loved it. He got really good, genuine reviews from microwave food that he was putting up as being like, you know,
yeah,
what do you call nice cuisine? You're a chef. What do you call that?
Good.
So something, what is it?
Tasty.
There's a word for it, high cuisine.
Hot sausage.
Hot cuisine.
Hot sausage.
Oh, fucking, I'm a Philistine, I don't want to talk about.
Email in if you know. I'm a Philistine too.
Yeah. Tonight,
I think you're always expecting podcast. Me to know. But
I don't. I do think that.
Oh, well, I'm glad you think that.
I consider you a sophisticated bastard.
Thank you very much.
So what's the TripAdvisor?
Well, I don't want to read through the reviews because it seems a bit harsh to actually go through
just
full reviews.
Do the titles.
So I'll do a few of the titles that I've found.
For the Crown and Anchor, this is not
this is for
pub.
The Crown. No, this pub's excellent. The Crown and Anchor next door, terrible.
Mm-hmm.
Here we go. So, go into the Crown and Anchor for Sunday lunch? Don't. That's one of the titles.
Concise.
This is actually probably the best one. This one just says, avoid. It's all anchor and no crown.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah, that's pretty good, isn't it? They're a pretty funny one. Awful service, woefully overpriced.
I'd say it's all crown and no anchor, just to be a dick. Crown is the prestigious bit of metal on the head. The anchor is the earthy, beautiful thing connected to a boat in the water.
I think what he's also saying, though, there is that...
There's no prestige.
But no, this is just opinion. Like you're pointing out the beauty of an anchor there,
yeah,
which
yeah.
is fine. But
which to me is the beauty of a pub.
And what he's saying there is there is no... he's saying there's no crown. He was expecting something good in
yeah,
a place
yeah.
that... So the place... advertises itself to be this sort of like, come here if you want to spend £7 on a pint and eat some food and love
but
the
to,
atmosphere.
But to me, that's what a crown represents is a false prestige.
A false prestige. Yeah, I totally get it. Prestige. Thanks. This one, speechless. That's the name of that's it. Just speechless. Next one, terrible. I mean, these all have their own reviews, but I'm just reading out. Reading out there.
I think most people's problem was with the food.
Awful.
You know, one thing that I
don't eat here.
One thing I
food
never...
hygiene.
Oh really?
This one just says food hygiene.
Oh god.
Oh my god. Oh burger meal. Oh my god. Look at this. I'm gonna have to read this.
Go on.
The food was really nice and two for one. You can't complain. However, me and my colleagues ordered the burger meal, and ants and other insects came crawling from the bowl of chips.
Oh my god.
Fuck me.
I did see an ant earlier, that's not a problem for me.
I decided to make the manager, the manager is in, what's it called?
Oh yeah, inverted commas.
Yes, there's a better word for that, isn't there?
Is it not?
I decided to make the manager aware of the incident, and her reply was, they're only ants, they can't hurt you.
That's great.
I'm totally shocked by her reply to such bad hygiene. I can't believe this treatment we received. Totally shocking, if you ask me.
Well, I think that's the best worst review we could have.
That was really that one's really funny. Three people like that review, and also we do have a reply, and
the
reply is quite long, so I'm just going to read it though, because I feel like if we don't read it, it's kind of
unfair. It's not fair. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you for your review. passive already.
Yeah.
That's passive. Because if I was running that place, I'd say, man, I'm fucking sorry.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say thank you for your review about the ants coming out of my chips.
I would apologise on the ants' behalf.
I think what you've done there is you've ruined an ant's good day.
Yeah. Those ants were looking for those chips.
Oh my God, this is what they said. Thank you for your review. I am pleased you enjoyed the food at the Crown and Anchor.
What?
I'm very sorry to hear that there was an ant on your table. That is unfortunate. However, during the summer, having the front doors and windows open, occasionally they may make their way in. That is not what they said.
They said ants, plural,
and other insects came crawling from the bowl of chips. That's not the same.
Caterpillars, grasshoppers, the plague of locusts.
I've spoken to the assistant manager regarding this issue. Issue is in inverted commas as well. And wow. she has assured me that firstly there was one singular ant and no other insects, inverted commas, on your table, which came from the wine list.
Insect detectives.
Not capitals from your chip bowl. Additionally, they have misquoted her when she said, they're only ants, they can't hurt you.
What she actually said was, get the fuck out of my pub.
Doesn't tell you. Further to this, she informed me, you decided we should give you free pudding.
Ant covered pudding. No
yes,
thanks,
please,
mate.
Yes, please.
A pudding of grasshopper soup.
Exactly. I can assure you it did not come from our kitchen. As far as she was concerned,
tarantula flambeur.
You all left in good spirits, and I'm sorry if this was not the case. Fair enough. This is the end of it now, but it just says the next title is Fresh Food, full stop. Cooked to order, full stop. Are you sure? that's the end of that. I'll stop that now.
You know, This is why I think it's good that we separate.
I'm going to say it outright now. It's a shit pub.
It's a shit pub. This pub is basically if you're
this
on
pub
this
we're
road,
in right now. If you're on this the Preston road, Park Brewery Tap.
If you're near this road, if you're near Preston Park, this is definitely the pub you should come to. That's what I'd say.
You can see in the picture that we're with the cat that was sat behind us.
Yeah.
Just looking over him now. He just noticed a little fly, a little hunter, aren't you?
So he loves the insects.
Yeah, beautiful little cat. So yeah, this pub's really cool.
Not only do they have a pub cat, they've got cheap drinks, they've got lovely staff, nice atmosphere.
They also serve the only sort of old school pie mash
in town.
In town, yeah, they're the only place to do it.
Well, I do know this, Wolfies and Hove also do pie and mash, but you know.
It's not going to be the same kind of pie and mash.
No, you don't think so?
No way.
It's got liquor with it as well.
Right, still not going to be the same.
Fair enough, yeah. I don't know.
Because I know Wolfies, and it won't be the same. These pies are actually sourced from Peckham.
Oh, are they? Wow. Yeah. If only they were eel pies, man. I've always fancied.
Yeah, they don't have eel pies, but the liquor really is an eel broth.
After we called time.
I don't know if you knew that about liquor.
What about it? That actually has...
Liquor itself is an eel broth.
Oh, shit. No, I didn't know that. Eels are boiled it.
So you boil down the eel bones and then you mix it with a load of parsley.
I thought it was just parsley, yeah.
Yeah, no, it's not. It's essentially an eel broth with parsley in it. And so that is the liquor. And no, I don't think Wolfies are doing that.
Fair enough, yeah, it's probably just like whatever, it's just like a pea soup.
Yeah, it'll just be like a nice sort of like parsley gravy. But like what these guys are doing, I mean, when it comes out, I mean, it's gelatinous.
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah, it's savage.
Because of the bones, yeah.
Yeah, it's savage.
Great.
I took Alice here and we had it and they're lovely. I mean, they're great. But I think, I mean, you'd probably love it, but... Like,
I'm sure it would, yeah.
It's hardcore, I must say, like, for, you know, for like an unsuspecting sort of... civilian, and just sort of like Jesus Christ. This is Alice had had a few bites, and I was like, "Do you know what the liquor's made of?" And she was like, "No, it's really nice." And I was like, "Eels." She was like, immediately, I could see she was like, "What the fuck?"
I wonder if are there actually places in London where you can get an eel pie still?
Yeah, there's a few places left. Mainly, it started in East London.
Do they have the bones in the pie still?
I doubt they'd put the bones in the pie, but they might do. I haven't had trash, but from the pie I had, in fact, the eel pies actually went out of fashion. A few decades ago.
Or probably the same reason as scampi did as well, right? Because it became expensive. Eels are now expensive.
Yeah.
Whereas eels used to be cheap as fuck.
Yeah.
They're the only things that could survive the Thames. Wasn't that it? At the time when it was super polluted.
Can't be that different now.
Well, I think I'm talking about the Great Stink, though, where everyone's dying.
Yeah.
You know, when all the sewers were backed up and shit.
Yeah.
What I was going to say is, after we call time at this pub, in between this pub and the next one, wherever we go, we're going to read off the little song that's on that pie menu that's outside, because it is fucking brilliant.
Yeah,
so you'll understand what happens.
That's
when you
great.
That
so when you when you come in here, there's just one menu, and it's a pie, mash, and liquor menu, and the menu goes around about this way: one pie, one mash, one liquor.
Does it even say what the pie is?
No, it's just pie mash.
Yeah, nice, I like
it. And then it goes two pie, one mash, liquor. Two pie, two mash, liquor. Three pie, it goes on like that. And that. I mean, I was sat at the bar here a couple of weeks ago, and a couple of blokes came in. They went, oh, are you serving food? And Sharon, the landlady, she goes, yeah, we're serving food. And he goes, great, got a menu? And she went, hey, it's pie and mash. And he went, oh yeah, like, what kind of pie? And she went, pie and mash.
I was like, excellent.
So he was like, all right. So he turned around to his mate, went over and went, yes, pie and mash. And then like they sort of went, oh, maybe we'll get out of here. And I thought, you fucking idiot. Send a bit of pie and mash, just your ear.
If they turn
tell you what, pie mash and liquor, £6.
Yeah, that's good. That's great.
£6.95, I think.
That's great.
And I did say to her, earlier on in the day, she didn't offer this to those gentlemen, but earlier in the day I was with Alice. Alice sort of brings kindness out of
people. Of course, yeah.
Two blokes going into a place.
Emanates happiness and peace.
Yeah, that's it. It's not the same. And so I came in and say a pie and mash, but she also went, oh, I'll knock you up a panini if you want one.
Oh, nice.
So this is the kind of place
it's like the Winchester.
Yeah.
You know, it'll do your toasting.
Exactly. It really is like that, yeah. So that's what this pub's got to offer. It's got a great feel.
Yeah. I've had a lot of good memories here, and even though I've only been here about maybe like four or five times, this could be the fifth time I've been here. Every time I've been here has been good. I don't have a negative memory. So it's nice to be back here, and I think on that note, call it time, and we'll see you probably at the Chimney.
Yeah, we're going to the Chimney House. And,
off to the Chimney,
yeah. We'll read you a poem on the way.
All right, call it time. Time at the bar.
Time at the bar, time at the bar, time at the bar.
See you soon. Pie and mash, pie and mash. Start again.
Ready?
Pie and mash, pie and mash. Loads of nosh for not much cash.
Warms your cockles, fills you up.
Wash it down with a good strong cup.
Pour the sarsens in the pie.
Come on, fella, don't be shy.
Loads of liquor, lovely stuff.
Us Cockney lads can't get enough.
It's Cockney grub for Cockney boys.
Come on, people, make
some noise.
Forget about those fancy tings.
Pie and mash is fit for kings.
So if you want some grub that's filling and
only costs a couple of shilling,
to the pie shop, you must dash.
Grab yourself some pie and mash. Pretty well done. First take. Cheers, man.
Cheers.
Didn't hear the click on that one.
Didn't hear
that. Because they are cans of Foster's.
Cans of Foster's. Where are we, Joe?
We are outside of a pub called the Chimney House. Yeah, Chimney House. It looks great.
It looks amazing.
It's got a lovely sort of blue, like it's a navy blue?
Navy blue crossed with red brick. Red Bourneville bricks.
Yeah, and they're good bricks. It's carved bricks.
But what's the problem?
It's closed.
It's closed.
Closed on Mondays. Wait, it's fucking Tuesday.
No, it's Monday.
Is it?
Yeah. You time travel for a second there.
Yeah, I did.
You've just gained a day. We lost an hour the other day, but we gained a day today.
I just gained a whole day.
So we're outside drinking Foster's from a nice convenience store called St Mary's Convenience Store. Mm. Bit of a 1980s film font they got going on there.
Yeah, you're the cool guy as well.
It's an interesting area. It's quite sparse.
Yeah.
Expensive houses.
Yeah, very, very locals pub, but it must just be closed on Mondays, and it must be heaving the rest of the time.
So we'll have to come back here.
Yeah.
We'll come back here. We're going to go and do a reconnaissance of the whole kind of Five Ways area, including the Parkview pub that we called earlier to check whether they're open. But we're going to head more into town now, I think.
Let's go down to the Argyle, which you said is across the road from the recording studio.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't mind talking to them.
Yeah, sure.
As well. I think we're going to carry on drinking these beers.
Nice. Yeah. Yeah. So we'll see you at the next pub.
Yeah. Cheers, man.
Cheers.
Hey.
What are we drinking?
We are drinking discounted.
Discounted. £3.60.
Pravas.
Fuck me.
£3.60, man.
Ooh. I can't think of a Prava that's this cheap.
Nah. There isn't. I mean, this because of the cool little card you gave me the other day.
In fact, I realised that this pub must be owned by the same people that run the Hare and Hounds, right? And the Joker as well.
Well, because they give out those cool cards.
They give out those cool cards, and I remember that they used to do a Prava deal at Hare and Hounds, which was about £3.60 as well.
Like that.
And now they don't do the deals anymore, so there's fucking basically no reason to go. And there's no Lachosa. There used to be a Lachosa burrito bar in the back of Hare Hounds.
We'll probably go down there later.
Well, maybe we will. It's kind of on our route. We've got a weird route now. We've gone a totally different way.
Yeah, because we went up over the train line and to the Chimney House.
Which was closed, as you know.
Yeah, so we just ended up here in $7. I think that we're still hitting every pub along the way.
I think we might have missed something. I think we went a weird route, but it's all right. We'll catch up with them eventually. That is the nature of a pub crawl as well, is that, you know, we are trying to get every pub along the route, but if we don't have Wi-Fi, if we don't have a map, we're going to end up at certain pubs. It's a natural walk.
Whichever one's open.
But maybe we'll do some episodes where it's literally like the missing pieces. You just go around trying to hit all the missed ones. You know?
Saw 3.
Exactly, fucking Saw 5.
Nice.
Electric Boogaloo.
Yeah.
So, you know. But this is an amazing pub for many reasons. What I'm looking at right now...
The Good Companions.
The Good Companions. This is what we're drinking.
It's a great fucking pub.
We're in the garden, which is kind of a bit of a cabana, bit of a kind of Colombian vibe. So we've got like palm trees, loads of bunting, some nice sort of lit bulbs, I don't know what you call that.
Tables everywhere.
But what's really important about this pub to us, mm-hmm. Joe, is that the first time that we properly... I mean, we were friends before that.
Yeah.
This was the time that we saw each other after a couple of years.
Yeah, that's right.
We met each other here in this pub.
That's right.
It was the first time we both realised we both lived in Brighton.
Yeah.
And we had a conversation here about...
I had just moved.
You just moved.
In fact, I had moved either that day or the day before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Being in Brighton, I was like, where's that fucking Bob guy at?
Yeah.
Give me that goddamn guy's number. Get me that guy's number.
And we talked about Sundry, which is a comic that we ended up working on for like a year writing.
That we've written.
Yeah, we've written. We've not only written that, we've written like parts of a spin-off. We've written a kind of almost a bit of a radio play based on it.
Yeah.
That was at least a year of us writing that.
Yeah, yeah.
And that all started in this pub.
Yeah, that's right, man.
So in a way, our creative collaborations began here.
Oh, cheers to that.
Yeah, cheers, yeah, cheers.
It's good.
Cheers once again.
How many years was that?
I don't know. I think... Because what I realised...
Because I'm 30.
I think I was...
fucking wasn't then.
Yeah, true. Just as fresh-faced now. If I do say so.
China.
I don't know how many years. Maybe 4 years? 5 years? Could be five.
I'd say five is a better shout, but it could be six.
Fuck me. I mean, God knows. That means we've known each other for like 8 years.
We've known each other for quite a long time, mate. Yeah, quite a long time.
I still remember when we met... in your house in London, and was that your house or was that somebody else's house?
I don't know.
But we were drinking. We were. You'll always find him in the kitchen at parties. I was in the kitchen.
Oh no, it was your fucking house.
Was it my house?
Yeah, I came to a party at your house in Edinburgh Castle.
Oh god, that was a fucking travesty. Of a party.
That was not a party. But the only reason I wanted to go because I knew you were there.
And
I was like,
beautiful.
So we must have met before.
Yeah.
But not actually met.
Yeah.
I think maybe I'd heard about you. Someone's going, oh yeah, Bob, Rachel's boyfriend Bob, and I'm like, yeah.
Did I have a shaved head at that point?
No, so I did see you with a shaved head at one point as well. That was either after or before. So
I think I've shaved my head like twice or three times now. I can't really remember.
You came to a Halloween party that I was at.
I was dressed as a lung cancer patient.
Yeah, and you had a shaved head then.
And I had a trachea.
Yeah, a trachea, obviously.
Made of a cork.
Yeah.
And I wore a hospital gown.
Yeah, it's really good.
What people don't...
Hard
often...
to talk to. A guy dressed like that. Okay, it doesn't matter what you got to say.
What people often forget about hospital gowns is that they're really great to dance in.
Right.
You know, your legs are free. I'm a skinny jean man. You're a skinny jean man as well.
Most of the time. Blue jean
and,
baby now.
And you know, but there you go. Denim ain't dead. But you've got this freedom when you're not wearing skinny jeans. When you're wearing basically what is a dress, essentially. You can suddenly, there's just this great freedom. I suggest that any man, I'm not, you know, just advocating cross-dressing, but any man should at least once in his life feel that freedom of maybe wearing a kilt, some kind of hospital gown, some kind of dress, just to feel how cool it is to be at a party and just, you know,
and
flexible.
Feel that kind of freedom.
It's great.
Feel
the
breeze.
Yeah, absolutely. You can wear underwear. I did.
Here
I chose to.
Comes the breeze.
Exactly.
Gomez. So that's what that song's about.
Is it? What, really? Like, well, maybe it is, yeah. But just, that just reminded me for some reason of how Wheatus, the band Wheatus, the lead singer, always wore a kilt. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Yeah, the other day we were in the Green Door store, which is still on the list. We'll have to go there again at some point. We're getting increasingly closer to the centre of town. But it wasn't really our scene. We realised that about kind of half an hour in. We were like, what the fuck are we doing here? Old men in a young man's game. And they were playing like Britney Spears songs, and then they suddenly got to Wheat Us, to the classic, what I imagine was probably a number one in the UK.
Probably.
Teenage Dirtbag.
Your name is Noel.
I had a dream, etc. And they used the censored version.
Yeah, I couldn't fucking believe
that. They were bleeping out.
That was when we left.
But what's amazing is
they bleeped out the word gum.
It actually felt like we were in a children's disco at that moment, because it was like how the fuck.
Yeah, that was shit. That was probably, so bad.
Probably what happened was that the discotheque, what's his name, the DJ. He's just doing it off YouTube. He picked the wrong version.
Yeah,
or something,
yeah, must
like,
be
know,
that.
Hang the DJ, but you know it wasn't his fault. But at the same time, it cemented it more as a children's disco, and then we left. Yeah,
we did leave. So we met here, good companions. Sean was with us.
Oh yeah. He arrived. Yeah.
He arrived and started talking about swimming pools full of semen. Do you remember that?
Oh yeah. That's super gross, but very inspiring.
I know. I mean, I've never had a thought like that in my life.
Yeah.
And so I don't know if I'll ever. I won't be able to ever forget it.
No.
I mean, it's just the worst thing ever, isn't it?
Yeah, it's very scary.
It's like, how did it get full? Like, it's a really. Whose pool is it?
But I think that's the kind of thing when you're thinking about science fiction. I actually was reading an article this morning about science fiction films that don't have special effects, that don't include things that are super like ray guns, CGI explosions, stuff like that. You know, when you think about science fiction ideas, it's better to think of slightly surreal, almost slightly realistic concepts. You know what I mean?
Sure.
You know, I know you'd probably need a lot of yogurt or whatever to fill a swimming pool.
Sumac.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, you know. But, you know, there's something about science fiction when it's done at its best. It kind of connects to things that you could see in your own life, but slightly more absurd.
Yeah, that's why that book you gave to me, The Titans of Siren.
Yes, that's
right. The Sirens of Titan.
The Sirens of Titan,
Kurt Vonnegut. Bob gave me, to the listeners, Bob gave me that book the other day.
Gave it to you twice.
Yeah, once 3 or 4 years ago.
Yeah.
And
we left it outside the pub.
Yeah.
Outside the quadrant.
Obviously. Who didn't give it back?
Which is a black hole of losing things, because I also lost a great sketchbook there full of drawings.
Yeah, and they just said, oh, what?
You know, actually, I talked to...
They throw them in the bin,
We won't name names, but I talked to one of the barmen that was there that day, and he went, oh, you mean the sketchbook with Robert Turnbull written in the front? Yeah, just chuck that away or whatever.
Unbelievable.
Maybe he didn't say chucked it away, but he said something like, yeah, don't know what happened to that. So obviously he either left it there, chucked it away, or he kept it for himself.
Yeah, maybe he's got it.
I mean, if he kept it for himself, fair enough. I'm glad it's still around.
Piping those ideas out to Netflix.
Don't get me wrong. I'm not stroking my own goat. I'm not tooting my own horn. I'm not saying it was full of the best art ever made, but it was important to me at the time. And I wish I could get it back.
Yeah, it'd be nice to see it now. So
when I was a child, I always imagined that. Sorry, there might be a bit of clicking there. When I was a child, I always imagined that the things that went missing were sort of stolen by gnomes beneath the floorboards.
Yeah, I was told by a woman once, sat in a park. I was sat in a park, smoking joints. Probably I wasn't that young, but I wasn't that old. So about smoking joints in the park time, and this lady, Henley Park in Penzance, this lady stops and she sort of stands around me for a bit, you know, like essentially at the time, like a weird woman, you're like, oh, fucking hell, like
crazy park lady.
Yeah, crazy park lady. And she just like wouldn't stop going on about how the Pixies love me.
Oh, she didn't mean the band.
Wouldn't, no, not if only. Yeah, not. Yeah, no, she definitely didn't mean the band. But yeah, she just wouldn't stop going on about how it's people like me that keep Pixies alive.
Wow.
Because I'm constantly dropping things, constantly leaving bits and bobs around, so they've got things to do and eat.
Wow.
And I suppose smoke.
Yeah. Of course.
I remember that because I actually. It's quite endearing. I thought, I like the idea of that. I like the idea that I'm that guy. You know, yeah. I like the idea that I'm a guy that drops things, but it means mythical creatures can live.
Yeah, sure.
And that's cool. At the time, I was like, fuck off. definitely didn't tell her to fuck off. But that's what I felt like saying.
Yeah. It's interesting as well, because I was actually reading the other day about how, you know, the belief in fairies and pixies and woodland spirits and stuff.
Yeah.
So obviously it's as pagan and ancient as... as any kind of, you know, horned god religion or anything Wiccan or anything like that.
Yeah.
It's kind of been dropped, I guess, because I don't know if it was, maybe even Shakespeare made it, he made it too mainstream. You know, he made all the fairies into like these like main characters, and suddenly everyone was like, "Oh, fuck, that's not real." I said, "That's just theatre, isn't it?"
Boring.
Maybe the fact that I think as well that fairies and pixies are so small, they're so tiny, made them like not cool anymore. Because
right.
I think, you know, obviously in Shakespeare, they're, you know, on the stage, they're fully grown. I don't think at any point they make, not that I'm a fucking Shakespeare dude, I don't really know much about it, but they don't make reference to the fact that, like, there's massive trees or,
I think
huge
I know
oranges.
Thinking about fairies makes me think about that Conan Doyle stuff.
Of course, yeah.
Right.
No, that's brilliant. You know, I've been reading a lot about sailed stuff recently in preparation for writing.
So Arthur Conan Doyle is the writer of most famously
Sherlock Holmes.
Yeah. And he also, this is where it gets real fun, when you know someone has written such a character that's so logical and sort of like he's sort of like
the beginning of CSI.
Yeah, the beginning of CSI, the beginning of Jonathan Creek.
Maybe the beginning of absolutely.
Yeah.
Maybe also the beginning of not only sort of detective fiction as we know it, but also the beginning of actual true detective work.
Yeah, like,
because I think he might have influenced that.
People to go, let's look a little bit further.
I'm sure actual experts would disagree with us there.
Yeah, well, we're not experts.
Of course not. No,
we're on a pub crawl.
Exactly.
The
an expert is just some guy from out of town.
I love it.
Mark Twain.
that's fucking great.
Still don't really know what it means.
Yo, no. We're both from out of town.
As you were saying, Conan Doyle.
Yeah, so Conan Doyle writes Sherlock, you know, it's all of this super logical, super reasonable attitude.
Deduction.
Super, at a high level. And at the same time, am I right that he was totally obsessed with mystical things, or was it just fairies?
No, it wasn't just fairies. So basically, he was part of, I don't know what the society is called, but like basically the spiritist thing. I don't know what you call it.
So
it's basically like those churches that practice, that still exist today, where they practice seances to contact the dead.
Right, yeah.
And basically, he was part of that movement, the first ever movement to really popularise that as being a science.
Now, that in itself is just amazing, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah, I mean, now it's pretty... You still see
churches...
You get
a guy like that that's so famous for writing a fictional character that in itself is... Sherlock Holmes is so famous to the fact they've got a statue of him on Baker Street. You know, it's a big brass statue of this fictional character.
Yeah.
Who was so rational that they made a real version of
him. There's even a museum to him where, of course, like, you know, you've got fake props and mad shit like
that.
Because
there's nothing, it's all fiction.
I know, totally
and
crazy.
And the man that makes him up is also totally embroiled in this world of mysticism.
Yeah.
Trying to prove that things aren't quite as they seem.
Yeah, I don't know, because I've never really read Sherlock Holmes, I really should. But I don't know whether or not he's more inclined toward the paranormal or not. Like,
no,
obviously,
he's not.
The Hound of the Baskervilles must be the one where they really address it.
He's not at all.
Because they think it's
the
like
Hound
a ghost
of the Baskervilles,
dog.
During the Hound of the Baskervilles, there's a moment, and I think it might be the only moment, that Sherlock ever sort of double takes himself and goes, I don't know if I can explain this.
Yeah.
I don't, because it happens to him.
Yeah.
Something happens to him, and he sees it, so he can't.
What is the explanation for the Hound? Do they explain
it? It's something to do with gas. Something to do with a gaseous
swamp gas.
Something like that.
Fucking hell.
Yeah,
interesting.
Something like that, yeah.
Swamp gas seems to explain a lot of things. We were just talking earlier about a classic murder in Australia where a university professor slash sort of scientist dude and a girl that he was seeing, he was cheating on his wife with her, both ended up dead in this lover's lane.
Oh, yeah.
And they had bits of cardboard laid over them. It's still a mystery to this day. No one knows what's going on. But the official explanation is that swamp gas from a nearby swamp asphyxiated them after sex, post-coitus, one could call that.
Well done.
And then somebody, they don't know who, but it could have been a mad hobo priest, got bits of cardboard and covered their shame, not realising that they were dead.
A mad hobo priest. Fucking excellent.
It's probably bullshit, but it's interesting that that is the official explanation.
It is, it's mad.
Swamp gas. But also, swamp gas has more mystical features as well, because You know, you heard of the term, is it St. Elmo's Fire? I think it is St. Elmo's Fire, where you see, because of the heat of some swamp gas, you get these weird blue flames that lick from the front of it. And the phenomenon, sometimes attributed to ghosts and spirits, which is known as the Will-O-Wisp, which is kind of a glowing orb of light, is sometimes attributed to the same swamp gas.
Oh, wow. So swamp gas is actually one of the most real creepiest things.
It's like a real weird... But I think we can explain it, but the thing is that it's so rare to be able to see this kind of thing that there's almost nothing on film of it.
They certainly don't talk about swamp gas in that Sherlock thing, but it's something to do with that. It's something to do with...
it's not just like Sherlock taking opium, which might have contributed to the fact that he saw a giant.
Yeah, the fact that he's a smackhead. But Conan Doyle, if I'm right,
he knew Houdini.
He knew Houdini, and he constantly sent him letters because those girls with the fairies at the bottom of their garden.
Yeah.
He was like an advocate of those girls.
Yeah, right? Yeah, and it was kind of a sad story for Conan Doyle because. He lived to see a mystery crop up. Mm-hmm. Girls see fairies at the bottom of their garden. Girls photograph fairies at the bottom of the garden. And then girls come out publicly and say that it was all bullshit, basically.
Really disheartening for him.
Yeah, and basically what it was, and you can see if you Google fairy...
It's stuff like that made him keep going with the Sherlock stuff. It's like...
I don't know if he did after that. I think maybe he was already finished with Sherlock at that point. I don't know, because I know Sherlock obviously died and he intended to kill him off for good, and then he brought him back later in this kind of big, you know, obviously for a very spiritual guy, bringing back a character from the dead.
Not that hard.
And I'm sure that influenced comic books, being able to, you know, you can kill Batman, but then he just comes back again. Yeah. Kind of shit.
So he knew Houdini,
and
he used to write him letters. I remember you telling me that.
And basically, one thing I would say about the fairies: if you do look up the pictures, you can see very clearly that they're bits of card or bits of paper. You know, it's so obvious, and they're like classical images of fairies. They don't look abstract at all. They don't look like a little person. They look like a classic like collage of it.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's ridiculous. Yeah. But yeah, so he knew Houdini. We've actually talked about this in the show before. Any hardcore listeners from the first season will know that we didn't talk about this. So basically, Houdini, he went to see several Houdini shows, and he started a relationship with him over letters, pen pals, you could call them. And they both respected each other immensely. And I think, you know, Houdini loved his work because it's obviously all about logic and deduction.
And Houdini was that guy.
Absolutely, the king of logic and deduction. But where they came head to head was because, you know, Houdini spent almost half of his life, comparatively short life, debunking mystics and debunking fakers, fake seance artists. The same, Conan Doyle was conducting seances in his house. You know, every weekend or whatever. So they really were opposed in that way. And eventually he said to Houdini over a letter, you must tell the public that what you do is magic, because otherwise they're not going to understand. And he went, no, you have to understand what I do. Houdini replied, what I do is illusion. I'm making out as if it's a supernatural power, but in reality, it has a basis. I just don't explain what I do to sustain the illusion.
God, it's so
And so he sent another letter back, and this time Conan Doyle's tone was very, very different. This time he was like, if you don't fucking reveal to the public that what you do is really magic, you are like, you're betraying humanity, you're throwing us back 300 years. And then Houdini finally sent one letter back that went, I'm very sorry, my friend, I'm not about to do that because it is illusion. I'm sorry you feel that way. And that was the start of their bitterness. And then from then on, there was never any kind of friendship.
That's such a shame. It's a beautiful thing, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, it really is. I think the first time we properly met, Bob, was in that kitchen. Always find me in the kitchen at parties.
Isn't he called Bob in that song as well?
Is he?
Yeah, they mentioned his name as like Bob or That's Bobby or something. Mint. Yeah, it's weird. Yeah, very weird.
So yeah, I found you in the kitchen at the party, and we started talking about God, obviously, immediately.
Straight into the God talk.
Yeah, straight into God. And I remember talking about God and religion and belief. It was about belief, really. We were talking about God, but it was about belief, and I was sort of. I was a much younger guy then, and not that much younger, but a bit. And I was going on about stuff like, you know, like...
Free energy.
Yeah, free energy, and how can people believe...
Nikola Tesla.
Stuff. Yeah, yeah. And we got onto the topic of the toaster. It was in front of you. and you were like, this toaster. You were like, what about this toaster? You were like, you know that if you put the bread in this toaster, toast will come out, right?
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah. And you were like, you believe that will happen. And I was like, yeah, I believe it will happen. I know it to be true. And you were like, sure. But why? And I was like, why what? And you were like, why does it toast it? I know, it seems like juvenile. It is, but it also isn't and at the time. And I was like, what do you mean? And you're like, well, explain how the toaster works. And I was like, you put it in and it heats the bits get hot and then I start tripping up and I'm like, I don't know how the... it's like it gets hot and you're like, what gets hot? And I'm like, the element in there gets hot. And you're like, how does the element get hot? And I'm like, because the electricity makes the element hot. And you're like, how does that work? And I was like, I don't fucking know.
Exactly.
And you were like, there it is, man. That's blind belief right there. You don't know how it works, but you believe that it will work.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It does work.
Yeah, yeah.
And that there is so many existential questions I had since then.
Yeah.
About my own virtues.
I'm pretty sure as well. I don't know if it was that night, but through various parties, I remember asking people the same question. And different people would give different answers about how the toaster works. Some of them were totally fantasy. Some of them were probably a lot closer. But yeah. the real reality is that the further you go back into saying, well, how does electricity work? Where does the electricity come from? How does the generator work? How do we do that? The more people are
the
in the dark.
The more people don't have any idea
and they don't have any
how
idea.
Any of it works.
It's not that there isn't a scientific basis for how
there
it
certainly
works.
Is.
There certainly is. I remember actually asking one of my cousins this question.
We can pull it up, but that's no fun.
That's no fun. And also, even while we might read the phrase, the filament heats up as a result of this, and we put coal into the machine, which produces a gas or a wind, that then the wind is converted into all that kind of shit, we still don't really understand it.
Yeah.
We understand it more like someone telling someone a story about, you know, there was a little gnome that lived in a house and did this.
Yeah.
We don't really grasp how it works. Now, that could just be because we're stupid. That could be because we're not intellectuals on a certain level. But even a lot of scientific theories are based on the work of other scientists, and those actual scientific certainties are rarely re-practiced again because they're accepted as certainties. So
sure.
It creates another kind of.
Yeah.
I'm not shitting
but
on
those,
science.
Those scientists that. When I think the way I think it goes is that if an experiment can be replicated with the same
conditions
results in the same conditions, then we can take it as a certainty.
Sure.
If we do it 100,000 times and it's always the same, we can say that is a certainty. The fact is that it isn't actually a certainty, it's just what we've found in our
there's no use in constantly redoing the whole gravity experiment because we just now it's just that's the way it is.
Yeah, I mean that's yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. I feel like I'm about to sound like an idiot once again. If you've got problems with what we're saying, email us tonightwithpodcast@gmail.com and tell me why I'm an idiot.
Yeah.
I'd like to know. And also, if you have any theories of how the toaster works, I'd love to hear that as well.
Yeah, and if you want to buy us a beer.
Well,
you probably could
do that somehow. Basically, just send a. We'll set up a PayPal. You send us the money to tonightwithpodcast@gmail.com and we'll drink that beer.
Yeah, yeah.
And we'll name drop you on the show.
Yeah,
we should set that up. We'll do that.
Let's do that. Yeah.
I'll make a mental note.
Let's do that. A PayPal account for beers that people want to buy us.
On that note, I think it's time at the bar, right?
Yeah, yeah, it's
time at the bar.
Cheers, man.
Cheers.
Cheers. We're at the French Horn in Seven Dials.
The French Horn in Seven Dials. What are we drinking?
Tap dancers all over the place.
There's tap dancers, there's poker games.
Yeah, this place is full of poker.
I wonder what you guys can hear.
Probably the tap dancers.
Feel free to email us and let us know.
Unless it's a parade of tap dancers just on their way past.
It sounds totally crazy, doesn't it?
It does sound strange.
So
French Horn. We're drinking Cronenberg, £4.60.
£4.60. It's classic. That's what it was.
That's
classic.
That's about right. Yeah, that's
right.
A tap class.
This garden is a tap class. Wow. We're in quite a nice garden. It's a very small garden, open to the street almost, but
yeah,
not
man.
Quite.
Yeah, yeah. It's got a little gated bit to the street.
What
it's really quite beautiful, actually.
What do they call that yellow lamp that's blinking there?
It's a pelican crossing.
Ah, so it's a pelican crossing lamp.
Yeah, it's a. Sort of a throbbing yellow bulb.
We once were compiling a series of words for things that should have words but don't.
Yeah.
We came up with the term chronosphoria.
Chronosphoria.
Which refers to a feeling like time has gone faster or slower.
Yeah.
You know, according to how old you are or whatever.
Yeah,
you
know, according to how long the time has been, sometimes, as we all know, when it's... when we're having a really good time, sometimes it feels like the time has gone really quickly, and sometimes...
the opposite, or whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
But the condition known as chronosphoria is what we're thinking.
That's what we came up with.
If that lamp doesn't have a special kind of name, we should give it one. What kind of name would you give that blinking zebra crossing?
I mean, it's called a pelican crossing. It's hard for me to say. What would I call a glowing orb?
What about pelicano?
Is that rubbish? It's a bit rubbish. What else did we come up with? Gangdalion!
Oh, the Gangdalion. So the other word we came up with, Gangdalion, refers to someone you meet on a night out, and you know almost as soon as you meet them that you'll never meet them or see them again.
But you also know that you're having a really fucking good time with them. And not,
it doesn't necessarily
no,
have to
I didn't
be
mean
that.
Fucking. I didn't mean like...
No. I know. But you don't have to be having a good time.
You don't have to have a good time.
No, it's just someone that you know that you meet on a night out.
But it needs to be a notable person.
Yeah, sure.
So it either needs to be a good time or a bad time. Because,
mm-hmm.
I mean, we...
True. Yeah, exactly. You could have, like, someone who's really fucking up your night. You don't think, like, oh, well, I'll never see this guy again. Yeah, that doesn't cross your mind.
Yeah, exactly. Someone that's, like, you're having a really good time with
yeah,
I suppose
yeah.
it's... Sort of reform the definition of this. I think sexuality needs to be taken out of it.
Yeah, sure.
Right? That makes sense.
Someone who you're with on a one night stand isn't a Gangdalion.
No, yeah, absolutely not. Yeah. So it's a friendship you strike with someone drunkenly on a night out and then you sort of know that you'll never see them again, and you do never see them again. And you go, God, do you remember 3 years ago that guy Derek?
Yeah, yeah. What the fuck happened to him?
Yeah, that's a goddamn Gangdalion.
I see what you mean about friendship, actually. It does seem to connect to it.
Yeah.
I can think of a few occasions where I just met someone and I never saw them again. And oftentimes you might make pipe dream plans as well. Oh, yeah, you take my number and then we'll do that.
That's the best.
And that really makes him... It actually makes him more of a Gangdalion.
Yeah.
Neither person.
And if you have never been out on a night out and never felt that, email in. I'd love to hear someone that's never happened to. That's all that happens to everyone. Well,
one time I met a guy in the Prince Albert, a pub which I'm sure very hopefully we'll get to very soon. And in the garden I met this guy who's working with Ben Wheatley, the director.
Oh, wow.
And, cool. You know, I've got a few sad stories about seeing Ben Wheatley in town. One day I was eating a croissant, my hair was in the wind, and I was drinking from a carton of orange juice at a bus stop in the rain. And I saw Ben Wheatley walk past, and I thought, what the fuck has happened to my life? So I met this guy who was working with Ben Wheatley on a film, or just finished working. It was what's that one where they shoot each other? What's that called? The big sort of gunfight in the warehouse. Is it Free Fire? I think it's called Free Fire.
I don't know, man.
It's the one which is like a big gunfight in a warehouse, either way. And I think he was working on that. And I was like, man, it'd be great to meet up with you and have a pint. We could talk about like films and stuff. And he was like, absolutely, yeah, take my number. And I took his number, and I remember I actually texted him a few times, so I tried not to make him a Gangdalion.
Yeah,
I tried not to make him
a real person in your life. Yeah.
But I reckon either he drunkenly woke up to those texts and thought, what the fuck, who the hell is this guy?
He thought, who's this Gangdalion?
Why is this Gangdalion texting me? Or what he thought was, I spilled a bit too many beans talking to this guy. You can't just work on a movie and then just go to someone and then just blab loads of information about it when it's only in pre-production. Mm-hmm. I think that's also a possibility. I don't know, but... Or maybe I just didn't...
I gave this Gangdalion too much.
But maybe that's the thing, that you become the Gangdalion unwillingly. You don't realise it. You
know? Oh, man, yeah, I think we've all been them.
Yeah.
I'd like to think I've at least been a Gangdalion for someone. I'd like to think that, like, in the morning, there's, like, some dude and he's woken up, or some group of dudes, and they've woken up and go, remember that dude last night, man?
I think that was especially true of our travels.
Something like that.
When you and me and Alex went on our travels around Europe, I think we were Gangdalions for a lot of people. You know, some people recognise us again the next day.
Yeah.
Some people just saw us for the first time. There's a classic. We walked into a pub in Amsterdam and this woman just went, you guys don't look like the Beatles.
Yeah, you guys don't look like the Beatles. That was a great place.
I mean, had these kind of moments with people. It must happen all the time, but it's more on a night out. You're on a park bench drinking cider with some mysterious man or woman, and then you kind of realise it will never happen again.
Yeah.
Should we talk a little bit about the French horn, this pub?
Right, so when you walk into this pub, there are poker tables on a Monday. We are on a Monday, so I think it's only on a Monday, but you walk in on a Monday and there's poker tables everywhere.
So
and
weird.
There's already dudes like throwing 20s and shit down on the table.
Which seems, it looked illegal.
It doesn't seem, it doesn't seem legitimate.
It seems dodgy.
The barman did say that...
I don't want to be a rat, though. You know what I mean? I'm not trying to rat these guys out.
There's no rat. And look, like the barman said that if the game is £100 or less and the house doesn't take a cut, totally legitimate. And there's nothing to say that those 20s that went down on the table, I mean, they were less than 100 that went down on the table.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
So that's legitimate.
I reckon.
And it did not look like the house had taken any kind of cut.
No, no.
So I'm not trying to rat anyone out, I'm just trying to say this is what it looked like when we came in.
So you walk into a room full of poker tables, it's got kind of a nice decor, you could say.
Yeah.
It's kind of a little bit crammed. We were kind of shuffling
past. It is
past
a bit
people.
Crammed. You kind of have to step up into the pub. Have to step up into it. You almost feel like you're on a stage in the pub, but everyone's on a weird stage.
It's actually like, in fact, the fact that we're smokers and we're smoking in this garden, it's a bit of a godsend. There's no one here.
Yeah, garden's the best bit.
The garden is the best bit. It looks really nice. It's just very casual. Aside from the tap dancing, it's a very calm and lovely place to be. In fact, the tap dancing kind of adds to it.
Yeah, it does actually. I quite like it.
If you can hear it, listener, dear listener, then I'm sure you'll agree. In fact, maybe for a moment we'll just.
And then maybe you heard that.
Maybe you heard that, yeah.
Very cool.
Tap dancing is one of the many skills I'd never wish to learn.
I'd love to see you tap, man.
I fucking wouldn't bother.
Hey, douche. You don't tap?
You don't tap?
You don't tap, douche? What the fuck?
All we do is we just chat shit about tap. We never tapped ourselves.
Yeah.
How can you really say that you wouldn't love tapping without even trying it?
Yeah, exactly. I, in primary school, went out with a tap dancer.
What's she like?
She did a couple of moves and I immediately broke up with her.
Really?
That's not a joke. That's not a joke. That's true. That happened.
Oh, my God.
I was down in the playground playing a bit of netball. I was playing netball. I wish it
was.
That's
all right, you know.
Playing netball with the gals. And I looked up onto the bank, sort of next to the school, and I saw my current girlfriend. Not current now. I'm in primary school, so bear with me.
Oh.
And the motorcycle. It's a loud motorcycle.
That was loud as fuck.
And so I looked up from the netballs, and I don't know why she wasn't playing netball, but I looked up at the netball and I saw her sort of doing some tap moves to some people around her.
On the grass?
And I thought, actually, no, it's up on the bank, not like the bank is grass, but up on the top it's a bit of concrete next to the school, so there's like a bench up there and you go down the bank and you're on the. Talking about St. Paul's School, I don't think it's called that anymore. But she was up there and I remember like playing a bit of netball, and I remember at some point in the netball game, I took a look and I look up there and I go, oh, there she is, my dearest. And you know, what was I, like 9, 10?
Yeah, sure.
Something like that. And I, yeah, there she is. And then I saw her do a move that sort of, it was like there was no tapping, it was just sort of jolting forward about 7 times. And it, like, she sort of looked a bit like a rugby player, but she was a very petite young girl. And but at that moment, at that very moment, I knew that it wasn't to be.
Oh, wow. Amazing.
I knew it.
Isn't it funny how destiny,
and in my mind,
destiny in a heartbeat could change just like that, just in one tap?
Yeah, one little, five sort of jolting taps. In my mind, I sort of thought, there's no way we can be together. And I'm pretty sure that she's a professional dancer now.
Wow, yeah, there you go. You know.
Yeah.
So in essence, she gets the last laugh, eh?
Oh, they always get, everyone gets the last laugh if I'm the other one. I mean, I don't get the last laugh. If I get any laugh, then I'm glad. If
you
I
sure? get any laugh. On a final note about this pub, though, I must say that there is something deeply atmospheric about this place.
Yeah, this is great. This is great. The garden that we're actually sat in, we've coined faux Parisian.
Faux Parisian.
Oh, you've been to Paris. Don't worry about that.
Yeah, exactly. We're trying to argue whether or not Paris itself is faux Parisian.
I was trying to argue that, yeah.
And I think you were saying Paris, more than anything, is trying to be Paris.
Yeah, well, that would make sense. But like you said, at the same time, out of all the cities in the world, Paris needs to try least to be Paris.
Yeah, exactly.
It wins on both. It wins itself.
Because it is Paris.
When I went to Berlin, I felt, and I kept saying for about 5 days, that it was like being in a giant yogurt pot. And I don't think that's dissimilar to what I thought about Paris either.
Right.
It was like a kind of, what I mean by yogurt pot is that it's, I mean without the
You're
yogurt.
You're not harking back to the old story of...
Sorry?
The swimming pool.
The swimming pool. Oh, no, yeah. Not that yogurt pot.
No.
Not that giant yogurt pot full of human DNA. But the yogurt pot of, like, you know when it's just, it's clean without yogurt, it's like this very smooth... you know, it's all sort of, it's all kind of ironed out by a plastic machine.
Oh, you
it's
mean,
kind of hollow,
you
it's
mean
empty.
The pot,
the actual
lacking
pot.
Of, yeah, sure.
Yeah. Sure. And that's how I felt in Berlin, and that is a lot how I felt in Paris. It was only in the last maybe 2 days of Paris that when we were there together.
We were there together, yeah.
That was when shit started to get really good. When you were about to leave and we were heading off, that was when things were really getting good.
Yeah.
I honestly think though that you can never really experience a city until you know someone there that really knows what the fuck's going on
sure.
to show you around.
Well, and the best thing about going to any city, wherever, we've said this before, we said this on the first episode, whether you're in Paris or Timbuktu.
Yeah, sure.
What you have to do is you have to go and find the oldest place.
Ooh.
Go in there, get a drink.
Yeah, next
keep your head down, don't go mad. Just have a drink for a bit and then let the people come to you.
Yeah, next time I ever go to Europe, that's exactly what I'll do.
Yeah.
So I'll compile a list.
Yeah.
It's really important. The places that are the oldest, even if they aren't the best bars, even if they're not the best pubs, you know, the best churches or the best museums.
Sure.
Something about their age gives them a kind of... It just gives them... It's
dramatic.
Not unlike
least.
A fine wine, I'm sure. It gives it time. It's like charged with some energy.
You've heard about those wine drinkers, haven't you?
How it's bullshit?
Being dishevelled.
Yeah, right. So
dishevelled isn't right, isn't it? That's
no, man, it's bullshit, right?
Yeah, it's bullshit.
That's the word you're looking for. Well, the idea is that even blindfolded wine connoisseurs can't tell the difference between like an Asda wine and a fucking if that's really true, I mean it doesn't surprise me at all, but you know
I a part of me really hopes that that's not true, right? Because I like the idea of exquisite things being possible, right?
Yeah.
But most of me just rallies up and like throws both fists in the air when it is true.
You fucks. I think honestly though there's a part of my soul which just hates arrogance. It hates someone like holding information above my head like a gun, you know what I mean, like,
sword of Damocles.
So it's like they know more than I do, and it's just like,
and you're a fucking idiot.
I've always felt that like my favourite beer is the cheapest beer. That's fucking it. You know, having said that, when I did used to drink wine back in London, when I used to drink wine, I used to get some wine that was like £1 or £2 from this off licence.
Yeah.
And it tasted like fucking pure vinegar, and you couldn't actually drink it.
Yeah, I remember that. Two for a fiver type shit.
Yeah, and there's cider.
Yeah, I lived
like,
in Seven Sisters up in London. Same.
Used to drink it. Yeah.
Two for a fiver.
Fuck.
Fucking hell, you wake up, I mean you talk about hangovers, fuck me, man.
Yeah, well they say, you know, there's a theory that Jeez. Like that they put this chemical in wine so that it retains its flavour, and while it's being in transit, so while the van is knocking it about, they put this chemical,
the sulfites, that's it,
something like that, so that if you get the cheaper ones they put less chemicals in them, so it actually gives you more of a hangover or something crazy like that, or,
right, that's
or maybe
mad.
It's the opposite way around. No,
I think it's the opposite.
Yeah, sorry, I fucked
so
that
the
up.
Cheaper ones have way more sulfites,
yeah, to try to preserve their flavour.
Yeah, so they're preserving the nothing in there by filling it with, and it's the sulfites that give you the head.
Lest we forget though that there is still no official explanation for the hangover. It's one of the kind of the great mysteries. Dehydration's the main thing.
Yeah, it's got to be.
But I also know as a hardened alcoholic.
Everyone knows that we're all dehydrated.
As a hardened alcoholic, I know for an absolute fact that hair of the dog is not a myth.
No, of course it's not a myth.
If you wake up with a hangover and you have a couple of beers, it does change everything.
Well, absolutely.
Maybe if you just started drinking and you weren't a hardened alcoholic, maybe that would be different. Maybe drinking a beer would just make you sick.
Well, yes, because like if you're not much of a drinker and then you drink a bunch and then in the morning you feel awful, when the next time someone puts alcohol in front of you, you think, no, you did, no way, no way.
I've actually heard similar things.
But of course, that's the trickster's muse. That's like, you drink through it.
I've also heard a similar thing with people who quit smoking for years, that they can smell cigarette smoke and it makes them sick. Interesting.
You know. I've heard that you're never really a non-smoker after you've been smoking.
Oh, that's true. That's also true.
You're just a smoker that's deciding not to smoke.
That's exactly the same with, you know, even AA says, like, fucking, you know, you're always an alcoholic.
Yeah, you're
stop
a drinker,
being an alcoholic. Yeah,
you're a drinker. Just stop drinking. Take up, like, open a haberdashery.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
if anything,
all of those cotton sort of all of those little cotton reels are going to give you a lot of time.
If anything,
to figure
out. If anything would lead me toward alcohol, it would be running a one man haberdashery.
I'd like to see that, just like you with cotton reels and like pins and stuff on the inside of your velvet jacket.
Yeah,
like, and you're just like opening it up to men in alleyways.
I still am not 100% sure what a haberdashery actually is.
I'm pretty sure a haberdashery sells fabrics. Things that you can do to fabrics, tools that you can use with fabrics. It's all about fabric and it's all about fabric and tailoring-ish kind of ideas.
I think with that note, we're going to move on to the next pub.
No, we're going to the cow.
And I think we're going to call time. Time at the bar.
Cheers, man.
Cheers, buddy. Cheers.
Right out.
Cheers.
Well, this is without a doubt the most comfortable I've been in a pub for ages.
Is it?
Oh, well, yeah, I mean, the seat I'm sat on. And just,
right, yeah.
You're not sat back.
I'm always on the edge.
Yeah, you're always on the edge of glory.
Yeah, I don't really, yeah, not
it's Lady Gaga.
The edge, but just I kind of feel on the edge of it. I never feel like sitting back in a chair. I don't really know what it is.
Sometimes the chair desires you to sit back into it.
Yeah.
And, like, these physicalities. I wish I could be less privy to, but it's sort of suction. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if I get sucked in between and eaten by this sofa.
What are we drinking?
I think we're drinking Prava.
Prava. You've got a nice beer.
You got
it
these.
Was, please, for us.
Please, Mr. Wade.
Please, Mr. Wade. This is only 17. Unfortunately, that's for a sad moment, it was £4.90.
No fucking way.
Yeah. It's exactly the same price as it is in the George.
That's too much money.
So fucked up.
£9.80 for
actually,
2 pints.
Originally when we came in, I was gonna be like, let's just get halves.
Yeah.
But then I don't know, something happened.
I mean, I would have this isn't the kind of pub that I like to drink in.
To be honest, if we're gonna call the pub a pub, a hotel a hotel, this is a bar.
This is a bar, yeah.
It's a restaurant as well.
It's basically a place that sells food that has a bar.
The good thing about this place is if you're looking for food in Brighton and it's a Sunday, I've got a huge problem where it's a Sunday, I'm always out on a Sunday and I'm like, oh, let's get some food. And then I realise everywhere is fucking selling roasts.
Yeah.
So if you don't want a roast, you're fucked. And obviously the kitchen closes at some point.
This place does that on Sundays.
Nah, but what they do on Sundays is you can have a roast or you can have a burger.
Oh, I'll tell you what happened that...
They change it up.
I've got first-hand experience with this pub. Yeah. I was here, I'd say, about 5 weeks ago with my little brother.
Oh, so you've been here before?
Yeah, I've been here before, yeah.
How many times?
This is my sort of my bit of town now, isn't it?
How many times have you been here?
I live up here. Overall?
Yeah.
7.
Oh, nice. Okay, cool.
Quite a few times.
I think I've been here, like, maybe twice.
Yeah, I've been here quite a few times. The fifth time I came here, so yeah. Not now, not the time before, but the time before that, I came down here so fucking hungover, man.
Yeah.
It was one of those heads where I was just like, and like, I was like, hey babe, let's go and do it. I'm like, yeah, let's do it, let's go. Fuck, thinking, yeah. Fuck, like, let's just get to the pub. Like, well, you want a rope, whatever you want, babe. Like, just take me to a pub.
Yeah,
get
yeah.
me the fuck to the pub and I'll be all right then.
Yeah.
And then my little brother, as usual, he's a maniac. He's a drinking maniac.
Yeah.
He's like, what are you up to? I'm like, it's Sunday, we're going for a race. He's like, see you in a minute. So he came up, it was really lovely. I was that kind of hungover where it's like a heavy hangover where when you hear the twitter of a bird in a tree.
It like annoys you, it like pierces your ear.
No, quite the opposite. I hear the twitter of it and I'm that hungover that it almost brings me to tears from the pure beauty of all life.
Wow. Like, that's more like an MDMA hangover.
Yeah, well, I get those, they're the kind of hangovers I get.
I get these, well, I get these like
sensitive, hangover. Emotional.
Oh, full on, man! Like, don't get friends on when I'm hungover.
I think that's because
I'll be crying because Joey's just done a face or something. it fucking pisses me off.
I think that's because you're a very perceptive guy. Though. I've said this to you before. I think one of the last times we hung out, I said it's like your doors are open to emotion all the time.
I remember you saying that.
A lot of people, their doors are kind of half closed or permanently closed, really.
Yeah.
But you're like, it's always wide open, man.
So I was down here with Alice and Sam, and I was that hungover and that sort of emotionally connected to the day that I was like, I got this, guys. I'll do today. I got this.
You were paying for it.
I said I'll pay for everything.
Holy shit!
Fucking
that
hell.
Was a mistake.
Yeah, especially with guys like, especially with gals like that. They drink bloody cocktails,
they get asparagus martinis,
espresso. Yeah, they're drinking fucking. They're eating truffle salt on their bloody chips.
Oh God,
and stuff, you know.
Like, snouted out by rare ivory pigs.
Yeah, these fucks. You know, so they had roasts, but like you say, they don't just do roasts. Because I couldn't handle a roast, so I was like, I can't do a roast.
No, they
right
do
now.
Burgers as well, right?
Fish and chips, man.
What?
I had myself a fish and chips on a Sunday.
Oh, wow.
They're eating roast, so I had myself a fish and chips.
Okay. How was it?
It's exactly what I wanted. I couldn't eat any of it. I mean, I wrapped it all up in tin
foil. You kept it for later.
I took it home, yeah. I ate it later, it was brilliant.
That's good.
But I just sat on that table, actually, that one there, just behind Bob. And I sat on that table there, and they were drinking their espresso martini. I wasn't thinking about anything. I think it cost me the day. I think it cost me we're talking about a couple of quid short of 100 quid.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, I think so.
I can't believe that.
Yeah, I think so.
Oh,
yeah,
my God.
I mean, it was fucking mental.
Wait. Let's try to take this into account. I'm interested in this kind of thing.
All right.
So let's say each meal must be, like, what, at max £10.
No,
right?
No, wait, I think we're talking about more 15. I think we're talking about
15.
15. Yeah.
So 15, 30, 45
15
quid.
For both roasts, probably more like a 10 for the 15.
And each, were they drinking cocktails, drinking champagne? What are they drinking?
No, they're drinking, I think possibly.
Oh, so the cocktails are like 7 or 8 quid each?
Yeah, and they're drinking a bunch of them, and probably Bellinis. Which is like champagne adding.
Sake.
Yeah.
What's the one that Hemingway
I think
about?
If I'd come and drunk here and eaten fish and chips by myself, I would have left on at most 25 quid.
What's the, you know, Hemingway used to drink at this one bar?
I don't begrudge it. It was a wonderful day.
No, fair enough.
I'm just saying that's the kind of place this place is.
Do you know what I'm talking about? Do you know what I'm talking about? Like Hemingway either invented, no, he didn't invent it. He used to drink this certain thing in a bar in Venice. The bar has since become like super famous because he mentions it in several works.
Do you not know it?
So it's like it's kind of a bit of a pilgrimage, not unlike our podcast. Pub to pub, 300 or so pubs, maybe 400, including hotels. People do the pilgrimage to go to this place. Writers do it, celebrities do it. Apparently, it's a bit of a, if you want to sort of see like James Franco drinking. You're in Venice, that's the kind of place where you're going to find it.
Oh, right.
Anyway, I read the TripAdvisors for it. Fuck me. People hate this place. They're like, it's not a Bellini, but it's got some specific, it's not a Negroni either, but it's like some specific drink that he used to drink. And they're like, it was all right. It was okay, but fuck me, it's a fucking 25 quid. Like, why the fuck? And then people talk about how the bar staff wouldn't look at them, they wouldn't make eye contact, how they.
Because all the bar staff are sick of people coming here to drink this fucking drink.
Apparently, it's pretty dingy as well. It's like not good, like, the hygiene's kind of shit. And what they do is they give you weird chicken nuggets, they give you these weird, like, chicken croquettes.
That sounds funny.
Yeah, and they're like, what the fuck is this frozen chicken croquette shit? And obviously, they're trying to live the writer's dream and it's not working out, but. You know, the true writer doesn't go to the place that's mentioned in the books.
Because he's too busy fucking writing.
Yeah, he's too busy fucking writing and doing other things in dive bars.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, you don't go to a place where it's like £100 a fucking meal.
I mean, who the fuck?
You know, I mean, in fact, we will have to at some point go to a bar that's so extremely expensive. At some point, I mean, £4.90, we think that's expensive. There'll be a point where we're drinking in the grand or something.
Oh, that's going to piss
like,
me off.
Oh, my God. It will happen, you know.
Yeah.
But, you know, I, as I always say, if it says bar and grill, it's a bar. That's it. So there'll be many a grill that will take
there'll
the
be many a grill.
Many a grill that will take the
hey,
fucking.
Hey, what's this tune?
It sounds like reggae.
It's not. It's not.
I've got a massive problem with reggae. I think
it's not,
I don't
it's
I don't
not a reggae
I don't,
song.
I don't know if my listeners or our listeners know that.
Oh, yeah, you, listeners from previous wouldn't have known this.
We never mentioned it. It seems crazy. No, we never mentioned. Yeah.
I mean, well,
I have an allergy.
So Bob's got an allergy.
I actually have two allergies. One is to peach flavoured water. It brings me out in an absolute rash. So the second allergy is reggae.
Is this braids?
No. No, it's not. I don't even know what braids is. I'm not hip enough to know what that is. I know who you're talking about, but I can't recognise a single song.
I tell you what, this. Oh, look at me! I can't believe. Oh, this.
Is it?
I like this.
I don't know what's happening.
It gets to this next bit of the song. Sorry, you guys probably can't hear this song. It's a.
I think they can.
Look at me. Yeah. I just can't believe what they've done to me. So everyone's going to know what that is now. It's a Major Lazer and the girl from Mo, the band Mo. Her name might be
Mo.
Mo. Mo. Yeah.
Is that?
It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. But yes, you do hate reggae.
I do hate reggae. As I've tried to say many times, it's not a racist thing. It's got nothing to do with racism. I think
when you say it that
I know, but I just think it's important to.
I know it's not racist. I know it's. I'm pretty sure I figured out what it is about reggae that you don't like.
And it's a beat.
Well, not only is it the upstrokes, but it's the let's just chill out and be happy all the time and just like chill out.
I hate that.
That's what I mean. Yeah, like you just
that really stuff. Annoys me.
Yeah, and I get that. Yeah, and that's endearing. I find that endearing that you feel that way.
Yeah. I hate any kind of artwork.
I'm certainly partial to that kind of.
I hate any kind of artwork.
I like to dance with the hippies.
I hate any kind of artwork that's trying to bury my head in the fucking sand. I hate that.
Sure.
And also, I know there's sad reggae as well.
Do you remember the reggae? Remember when we were at the Admiral?
Yeah, that guy was like,
listen to the goddamn lyrics.
Yeah.
And you were like, I could see in your face, you were like, I'd like to, but it sounds like shit.
Yeah.
It sounds like they're trying to have a good time.
What I hate is that. Fucking hate it.
I know. That brings up. Sort of visions in my mind of places that I could be with groups of people, mostly beautiful young white people listening.
Super white.
Yeah.
Pale as the morning snow.
Yeah. A couple of braids here and there in their hair, a few beads, certainly slightly unwashed, but totally proud of it. Acid's around. Like, it's this kind of crowd. And it's that kind of thing, and they're heavily, in my mind, sedated.
Yeah. I think the thing is that, you know, as a drinker, I find great comfort in listening to bands or looking at the work of certain artists who themselves are drinkers. It brings me a level of comfort. Right. And I imagine for the heavy marijuana smoker, it must be a similar thing. You listen to bands that you kind of know or assume smoke a lot of dope, and they're sort of, they're creating a certain rhythm, a certain beat that's made under the influence of
dope. I mean, I am quite the marijuana smoker. I heavily smoke, and I have never been a reggae guy.
Not
to say that I don't like reggae, I don't like reggae.
Do you feel though that like when you smoke it?
Funny enough, but I don't.
I've seen that band. I was headbanging in that band when I was about 15.
Was that 10cc?
10cc, yeah.
Yeah, see, and like,
I was the only guy. I was the only guy song, even dancing. Yeah. In the fucking crowd.
So there we go. Oh, you're telling me I hate reggae? I saw 10cc.
Yeah, but they're not actually reggae.
No, they're not a reggae band, but they're fucking great.
They're all right.
But anyway, yeah, they're pretty good.
It reminds me a lot of this, like, you know, Chaz and Dave.
But what I mean about it, like, I like reggae music, you know, but I don't know enough about reggae music to like.
No, I remember once.
If we were going to talk, like, I don't know enough about reggae to sort of have any, like, I mean, my opinions on how it sounds, how it feels, like, I'm sort of classic in the sense of I'm a utopian sort of classicist white guy in England that like knows Bob Marley.
It's interesting you know how much race comes into it, isn't it?
Well, it's kind of boring.
I love shit tons of hip hop that of course is not made by white dudes. I also like some like crazy white Polish hip hop and crazy stuff like that. But yeah, yeah. Most of the time, most of the hip hop I listen to is done exclusively by black dudes. And I yeah, fucking
yeah.
love it.
Yeah, yeah.
So the fact that I don't like reggae is much more to do with the fact that that beat, that rhythm doesn't flow with my fucking bones.
Yeah, sure.
It's not part of my brain.
You're like, this is not giving me.
I didn't watch it. It's terrible because I didn't actually see it, but I saw there was this documentary someone did recently on a girl who had some kind of brain injury, and she actually couldn't listen to music without it sounding like insane, just like clashing and stuff. Oh man,
you're telling me about this. Yeah, what was that about? That's fucking amazing.
When she would hear music, it would just sound like noise. So she had to rehabilitate herself into hearing music again and understanding it. God knows how that
probably
happened.
By playing through music. I'd love to see that.
I think she was playing music herself.
Yeah, she'd have to play music.
She was doing like single note stuff and weird things like that.
To go through it, like, yeah. Note by note to understand. Yeah, but, I mean, like an incredible documentary.
Absolutely.
Do you know what's cool?
I don't think it's Vice, but it's something like that. I don't know.
It's cool. It's cool enough to be Vice.
Well, I don't think it's Vice, though. But anyway, either way, I think it's interesting that... the way where we're born, where we're from, you know, in many ways ends up making sort of creating our predestiny of what we'll like to hear, yeah, and what kind of music we like.
Yeah, because I was brought up by racists, so I only listen to the Clash.
I don't even know what that means.
That actually was a joke, but I'm glad it worked.
I don't know. It's funny, but I don't know what it means.
No, I mean it's a joke. It's total lies. I mean.
But
I wasn't brought up by racists, and I hate the Clash. That's the actual truth.
But I hate any music which I feel is disingenuous as well. And I think that might be a thing. You know, we you know, what do they say? Like, the eye only brings what the eye brings means of seeing.
Well, that sounded good.
And I think that is the same for the ear. You know, selective hearing, right? You know, someone's saying something, you just don't hear it.
Yeah, yeah.
It could be the same for music, you know. Yeah. If you don't give something the time of day, you can't really hear what they're saying.
Well, I mean, I get this all the time. It's like, man, I get this all the time. Like, all the time. Like, if I ever, which I don't actually, like now, is one of the times where I'm sort of having to listen to music that I'd never listened to. And this music that's playing right now, I wouldn't go as far to say as I hate this music. But I would go as far to say as that I really don't like it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I really don't like it.
Who is this?
By a guess, I'd say Florence and the Machine.
That's what I thought. And also, I thought, how the mighty Florence has fallen, because that sounds like garbage.
Yeah, because she used to be great. But, I mean, well, did she ever? Was she great? I don't know.
But certainly catchy. Okay. I like that Midas is King song. I like that.
I like the Dog Days.
I just
like the lyrics because, like, I like the dog star, you know, like the dog star moon, yeah, and
nice
like
symbolic
Sirius.
But she's a great performer. She's a great singer.
I'm sure she's fantastic. This is something that I've never wanted to take away from sort of my inability to appreciate pop music in its purest form, and I've always felt a little bit ashamed of it in a lot of ways, like, because I understand that people are really enjoying this music.
Yeah.
Whatever music is.
And we should enjoy the fact that people are enjoying
it. And I should be cool about that. And a lot of the times I have, but certain times in my life I've been so uncool about it. I've been like, I don't want to listen to this.
That's because we're a bunch of goths though, man.
Yeah, maybe that's it. Maybe that's it. But I just, I don't want to, like, and but it's it but this is what I mean. Is I don't think it is just being a goth. Yes, I am a goth, you know, in a spiritual sense, but I don't think that's why I don't like pop music. I think I don't like pop music because the actual, in the same way that
you
you're
do like
about,
pop music, it's just not from this era.
That's a good point. That's a good point. So what I'm talking about is that when there is music that I listen to and I just don't like it, it's not about the performer. It's not about the writing.
Yeah.
It's more about the sound quality and how it was produced.
Sure.
And how it was mastered.
What if it sounds too clean?
Yeah, it's like it's got this certain feel to it, and it's got a certain, it's probably got something to do with the intentions too, because like,
but it's an
if
easy,
there's like a
yeah, yeah,
like,
sure.
So what it's about for me is like, like maybe like how reggae makes you feel.
My bones shiver.
And that's exactly it. I listen to something like I've had this with Katy Perry, for instance, and I love Katy Perry. I love a bunch of her
stuff.
I
can't think of a song that I like.
No, I don't like her music. I just think that she's kind
it's
of
cool. The idea of like a Christian girl from church ends
that's
up.
What,
you know,
yeah, it's kind of funky.
Russell Brand, kind of cool.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. Like the narrative, the story. I love that. But like the actual music, when it's on, it makes me want to drill a hole into my fucking skull.
Trepanation.
It makes me want to leave wherever I am. And what I mean about that is that comes from the subconscious.
Yeah.
Like that isn't something that I planned out.
I take it a step forward.
Because I'd love to just love it, everyone else.
I take it a step forward and I include myself within this, what you're talking about here. And I think it's a level of arrogance that makes us refuse to even hear something in our ears. It's like we have golden ears that can't be, my ear is too beautiful for this shit.
Yeah, right, that's not what.
No, but I think that is what it is. I think that is what it is. I think it's a level of arrogance, which I think I'm arrogant as well. I think the same. And I think it's that we can't get down with the music of the people.
I love that you think that's how it is, but I don't agree with that.
I think
man.
That's what it is.
What I think it is I think that it's a vibrational sort of biological thing. That's why you have genres of music because like these guys over here don't like listening to women like dancing in their pants singing about things that men want them to sing about.
I can't hear them dancing
in
their
pants. What they want to hear is men dancing in their pants singing about how awful it is to be a man that dances in their pants.
What the fuck?
What I'm talking about is the difference between genres and how people sort of accidentally or biologically are attracted to certain parts of the world.
Let me ask you this. What's your least favourite genre of music?
My least favourite genre of music?
This song reminds me of mine.
I'd agree.
What's yours?
Electro swing?
That's mine as well.
Well, there we go. Cheers to that.
Because
electro fucking swing.
It's interesting. I was reading a list of
what they're doing is they're taking a whole bunch of good stuff and making a mad world out of it.
They just destroy
it. What I'm saying is that's not because you're not arrogant because you don't like electro swing.
I'm certainly not. I'm not hip with the swing crowd or whatever.
Who gives a fuck?
Yeah.
Whoever wanted to be hip with the fucking electro swing.
No, but I think there actually is something.
But what I'm saying
brutal.
Is there are people that listen to electro swing and they totally love it.
No, but this is actually very light electro swing. What I know of, or maybe Gypsy Swing is the one that I'm really terrified of. But there's one where it's way faster than this. It's like double the speed. It's
Gabba style.
It's, like, it's almost like Gabba. Yeah. That shit, oh my god. Fuck, that makes me want to puke immediately when I hear it. And that's not because I've done loads of drugs while hearing it, which I have, but it's not even connected.
Sure, yeah.
There's something very, very infernally bad about that music. This is very bad though as well. Oh god, it's so quirky.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, it's like
nails on a chalkboard.
But what I mean about that, like the reason that that quirky—that doesn't make. That's not because you're arrogant.
We're fighting our own ideologies all the time, though. Like if we try to enjoy something, if we try to like something.
But I think there's something biological happening. We know that sound waves create frequencies, and those frequencies mess with our molecules.
I immediately thought about Jurassic Park with the vibrations of the water.
Yeah, that's great. Or what about those guys that just like. Play a bit of music with sand on a board and the sand changes the pattern.
What about the scientists who did an experiment in that lab that they thought was haunted? It was recording the frequency of scalpels that would rattle on their own. And it was a frequency that made people look like be sick or they're terrified
or
run away.
So what I mean is like biologically we're sort of as accidental as it is to have certain bodily features, like are you tall, are you short, are you fat or thin, like, you know, is your left arm longer than the rest, like what I mean is it's a biological disposition, an accidental one, like it's not something that's determined by parents, but somehow and every now and again you will have a man like Danny Filth born that can listen
I saw that man.
Anything else makes him physically vomit.
I saw that man
play. It's not because he's arrogant.
I saw that man play, and the Cradle of Filth was so bad. They were colossally bad band. Yeah. The only good thing about them was their giant puppets on stage, which were pretty sweet. But the actual band themselves and the music they played is fucking garbage. fucking fair awful. But what I was going to say is I think you and me are both right in different ways. Because I think, like, for instance, with country music...
Oh, wrong.
You know, let's think about Miley Cyrus's dad, like Billy Ray Cyrus. Billy Ray Cyrus, I'm your daddy now.
Billy Ray Cyrus. That's a Stitches quote.
That's a Stitches quote.
If any of you gangsters...
YouTube.
Stitches. I'm going to be a gangster forever.
Oh, I mean, yeah.
He's so fucking great.
Always got a soft spot in my heart.
Now, what I'm saying is Stitches, good.
Yes. Billy Ray Cyrus, bad. Bad. Right? But what I'm trying to say is that Billy Ray Cyrus, like, don't break my heart. My achy, breaky heart, probably in number one somewhere, Texas.
I just can't take it anymore.
I mean, the fact that we know it, it's universal, you know.
And if you break my heart, my achy, breaky heart.
But the thing is that it's not a great song, is it? It's not a great song. That's a bad example of country. I've listened to a shit ton of country music. Which I don't like at all.
Yeah, country's bad, man.
And in fact, I sometimes I like it a little bit ironically, which I think also makes me an absolute fucking hipster twat.
I think it makes you mad. You know? Because it's the same reason that you think, like, instead of what...
Guilty pleasures.
No, but it's like the same reason that, like, sometimes country you like ironically is the same reason that you'll, instead of watching a comedy show, you'll just watch a B-movie horror film.
And I find that funnier.
Yeah, because that's like, you're actually going to laugh there. You're going to really have fun there.
Let's just redefine what we meant there. So basically what it's saying is, if you watch a very bad movie, which is not intended to be a comedy, I personally, Bob speaking here, I find that funnier than watching a film which is actually intended to be a comedy, like Ted. Or,
whereas, of course, as you know, I'm Anchorman. The other way around. Like,
you actually find things funny.
If I watch a B-movie horror film, I'll be like...
This is shit.
Yeah, I'll be like, this is shit. But I like it. But it's kind of funny. But I'm not, like... For me to laugh at that makes me feel like I'm giving those guys a bad time. Like, I know they tried their hardest and they weren't trying to make it funny.
I think we're getting onto something. So I think we're connecting to something.
So I don't like to do that.
I think the reason why I find that stuff funny, why a movie that's badly doing something but trying in earnest to do it, is Schadenfreude.
Yeah, exactly.
It's the same thing as someone falling over, getting hit by a fucking cricket bat.
And I've never found that shit funny.
No, but I never found that stuff funny in You've Been Framed.
Yeah.
You know, because when actually I see someone get hurt, I feel the pain.
Yeah.
I think I'm so perceptive and so emotive. For some reason, I just actually physically, I'm, oh!
Yeah, you can't help it.
Someone gets kicked in the nuts, I fucking feel it. If I see it on the screen, I'm like, ah, you know, it really hurts.
Yeah.
But in a movie, when I see a filmmaker, they've got the whole set, they've got all the actors, they've got everything going on, and it's still shit.
Yeah.
I find it fucking hilarious.
Yeah, which is amazing, but I haven't found it. Whereas, it's
dark, isn't it?
Whereas I love comedians for
you're actually laughing with people. I'm laughing at somebody else's expense.
But I'm also laughing at the fact that, like,
good writing.
Yeah, what I like is like I suppose for me it's like comedy is an intellectual endeavour for me. Like, it's something that's worth its own piece of time.
So you're actually laughing at the fact that someone's crafted a joke that really lands.
That I didn't know that would land, and then it hits me. And I go, fuck, man, that's funny.
Whereas I'm trying to seek out jokes that weren't intended to be there.
Yeah, and I'm finding that funny.
Weird.
Yeah, that is weird.
It is a difference. It is a massive difference.
But
as I've said to you before, you know,
my father's more, like, he won't watch
comedy stuff.
No, he doesn't find that stuff funny. But he's like, he likes the stuff that's.
But you know, I reckon if I spent a solid week listening to reggae, I'd find a lot of reggae I loved.
And I
reckon if I spent a solid week looking at comedy films, I'd find stuff that I loved. And probably what you should look for in both reggae and comedy is stuff that exists before, like, 2000. Things from the 70s and the 80s. Yeah.
You know, maybe you should look for reggae that was just done badly.
Well,
maybe you should just look for reggae that was recorded in a garage with, like, some guys that actually were just there.
One of my good old friends, Sam Worthington, probably not listening, but if you are, hello.
Hey.
He introduced me back when I lived in Cardiff to, like, what was the beginnings of reggae, which was, like, these kind of early jamming sessions. There was a special kind of term for it. I can't remember what it was, but it was very much unlike reggae. It had similarities, but it was different, and I remember really enjoying it.
Wow.
But I just, you know, I'm not knowledgeable enough now to know what it is.
Yeah, that sounds really
By the way, if anyone does have a reggae song that you think that could be the gateway drug for me getting into reggae, please send it to Tonight With Podcast.
And also, if you have any gateway drugs...
We'll take those as well.
We'll take them.
Yeah, just post it, please. shall we, on that note, call time at the bar?
Yeah, yeah, we've finished our beers, haven't we?
We're going to go a peculiar direction, and we're going to see you at the Shakespeare's Head.
Cheers, man.
Cheers.
How's it going?
Where are we?
We're at the Shakespeare's Head.
Shakespeare's Head.
The sausage factory.
The sausage factory is, in many ways, a sausage factory.
Yeah.
I've been here...
They only serve sausage and mash here. But plenty.
Do you still do it?
Huge plethora of sausage and mash, yeah.
I've been here, like, over 20 times.
Yeah, yeah.
I've been here a lot of times.
I've been here a bunch of times. I was here yesterday.
I used to be here because an old friend of mine lived nearby. And then, for various other reasons, somehow we found ourselves here. Do you remember after the night where we went to the wassail in the cider factory, farm?
We came here.
We came here straight afterwards.
Yeah,
cab, or not a cab, the family.
The family that brought us back from the wassail.
What's
a wassail?
A wassail is an ancient British ritual, maybe not even British, who fucking knows, European ritual surrounding blessing the trees. Cider trees, particularly the orchard, by rubbing pudding on them and pouring cider on them and getting the devil to eat through insects to
That's
eat
right.
away the pudding.
Yeah, yeah. And there's these wassail, these wassails are fucking mad, aren't they? Like,
yeah.
So there's lots of singing, there's lots of drinking, there's lots of ritualistic fun.
Hopefully, by next year we'll have recorded some for this podcast, eh?
Yeah.
Why not, right?
Yeah, why
fucking
not?
Absolute wassail special.
Yeah, into Lewis. Remember the one we went to in Lewis?
Yeah, fuck it.
That was really a crazy wassail.
Crazy stuff. But, you know,
we were here after the wassail, he was here.
Yeah, but I think it was for this pub is kind of, I don't know what it is, but there's a lot of memories, there's a lot of nostalgia surrounding it.
I love this place, actually.
It's a nice
place. I really like it.
When we entered the building, we attempted to immediately get discount drinks.
Yes.
And the way we did that is by suggesting that we worked in the lanes, which wasn't a lie, because Joe does actually work in the lanes in a restaurant. But we weren't believed, so there was a kind of...
There's a kind of dance.
Kind of a bit of a dance.
Where do you work?
Prove ourselves.
I work here. And well, they're like, oh, do you?
But it's not a lot of money that we're asking to knock off, but it was still a crazy thing. Until, of course, we realised that the bar lady herself is actually in a relationship with our good old friend Reese.
That is incredible.
Who's run many of the best bars.
And they used to run this one.
Used to run this one.
Used to run Quadrant.
So if only we just name dropped him to begin with, we actually probably would be fine.
Yeah.
And I think actually that's the thing that I've learned from all this. Just name drop Reese wherever you are and you might get a discount. Just say, we're mates with Reese. And then that would have been fine. Because we're mates with Reese, you would have been like, oh yeah, cool, no problem.
Yeah, no worries.
Instead we went about it like a weird...
Of course you would, because they're going out. What are the chances?
We went around it a weird backdoor informational way and tried to sort of, you know... You tried to circumnavigate the globe and it just didn't, you know, it ended up with a weird, awkward argument.
Yeah, sorry.
Was what we could have just done is name dropped our main man.
The main man.
And it would have been fine.
So this place is great.
Right now, what are we looking at? We're looking at loads of hanging light bulbs. Always a good sign.
Yeah, when you sort of...
It's a garden, pub garden.
Sort of twine between buildings, between the walls, there are light bulbs hanging. It's gorgeous. The outside here is kind of
like... I just
want
to make a few corrections because I didn't say it at the time. When you were talking about Wassail and Lewis, you meant one in West Worthing, right?
That's the one I meant.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I was just making sure of that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's confusing.
Because I got kicked out of Lewis.
We go to the Lewis bonfire every year, which we should, you know.
I got kicked out last year, remember that?
Well, what happened was a police officer was being a real dick to you because you stopped a child from blowing themselves up.
That's exactly what happened.
And basically the cops interpreted it as, this man is an explosive expert and needs to be taken out of the city.
I was banned from the city.
immediately.
Lewis Bonfire is a year is an event that happens every year.
It's a huge
on Bonfire Night, yeah, right? Huge remember the 5th and
Gunpowder, Treason and Plot.
Absolutely. And it's an incredible event. I don't think there's anything like it in East Sussex. In fact, there's probably
no, there's nothing like it in the world.
Well, I don't know. I've been to some there's crazy.
There is nothing.
We went to another one. We went to Wassails that were like that.
There is nothing quite like the sort of magnitude that Lewis Bonfire Night holds. Lewis Bonfire, without a doubt, is the biggest and craziest bonfire night in the country, and therefore.
What about Up Helly Ard, the Shetland Islands?
Yeah, but that's a wassail.
It's kind of, yeah.
That's a wassail. That's not a bonfire.
Sure.
That is a. I mean, that might top trumpet as a wild night out, but as a bonfire night, doesn't even come into the competition.
Yeah, true.
So Lewis Bonfire Night really is the most wild bonfire night in the country, and it's also by proxy or by default has to be the wildest one in the world.
Yeah, maybe.
It has to be.
I mean, it's only England that celebrates Bonfire Night anyway. Right?
So then it must be. Yeah. So the most insane Bonfire Night you can go to is in Lewis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
in the world, in the entire world.
Basically what they do as well is they divvy it up into different bonfire teams.
Yeah, they must have five, six bonfire teams.
And you kind of, the idea is you're supposed to kind of sort of follow around your team and then pay for a ticket when you get to a certain area.
Yeah, so you can pay to get into their sort of
which
camp.
I've literally never done. No, every time that I've gone off. There, you know, it's
no, we're there drinking cans on the streets.
Yeah, exactly. You know, it's kind of mental.
It's fucking mental. You've never seen anything like it. I mean,
if you live in England and you're listening to this podcast and you haven't been, this November the 5th, you should come there. We'll be there.
Yeah, you really should. Like, if you think that you've seen a bonfire night, just Google. Yeah. Like, I mean, most of the last few years have been sort of, like, they're burning effigies constantly. So we got
could effigy. Be of anything.
Yeah.
What, one year it was Kim Jong-un.
One year it was David Cameron fucking a pig.
Was it really?
No, I don't know.
Oh God! Well, it would be good.
No, it was. There was. Yeah, there was Cameron and a pig. Yeah.
Wow.
There definitely was. You remember when that?
And they blow them up. At the end of the.
Fucking blow them up.
Yeah, they blow.
But this year it was Trump on. What was he on? Like on a. I don't know.
Trump on a trout.
Yeah, Trump sitting on a trout.
riding a trout right to town. It's funny because actually, when I was walking to the first pub,
sorry to talk about Trump again. Sorry to interrupt you there, man. Yeah. But like, did you hear? Did you show me that thing with Trump, or did someone else show me that?
What was it?
Like, I'm not a here, there, or go there anyone with when it comes to Trump. But like, I of course I'm observant to things that I find. There's a. My brother yesterday, he showed me, there's a bit where Trump, there's this recording of Trump, where he's talking about how great America has been, of course, that's what he talks about, but there's this one specific speech he was talking about, and in it he accidentally talks about how one of the greatest achievements of America was the abolition of civil rights.
What?
Have you seen that?
I haven't seen it.
I just heard it. I didn't watch the video.
The removal of civil rights.
Yeah. So what he clearly. Yeah, I mean, like anyone with a anyone can clearly tell that what he means is what he's trying to say is the abolition of slavery. So what he's saying.
But he says the abolition of civil rights instead of slavery.
Yeah. So he goes. He goes. America is a great nation, and I can't do his voice. I don't know, you know. But anyway, he goes. America's a great nation, and
it's a great nation.
It's great. It's a great nation.
Yeah,
and he goes. It's a great nation, and we've got a lot to be proud about in this nation of ours. As you know, as in the. And then he says one thing, and then he goes, and of course the abolition of civil rights and of course, and then carries on talking.
Oh my God.
And then you can hear him like he's like over his words. You can hear it in, like, I mean, I heard it last night and I was like, that is
that unbelievable. Is, I mean, it's pure poetry. But when the president, president of the United States actually says one of the things that we can be proud about as a country is abolishing civil rights, even if it's by accident.
I saw earlier when I was walking toward Preston Park, I saw a piece of graffiti, a sort of poster that was up on the wall, and it had on it a drawing of President Trump, I believe, as a pig. With a red circle around it and a line through it.
Yeah,
and it said liar, liar over it. And I thought, first of all, we're in England, so I don't know what relevance it really has.
Yeah.
And secondly, I thought, who doesn't think this man's a liar?
Yeah.
And also I thought, this guy's already so famous, we already know he's a liar for years and years.
We've known that forever.
This is barely a protest.
He's always been a liar.
This is barely a protest image. And what I thought was, making a cartoon out of it actually made what is already a physical cartoon into more of a cartoon. And then I realised, I was like, have cartoons corrupted us? I was like, have cartoons allowed us to make what's really savage more silly? And then we understand and we accept them.
And make it easier.
So I actually thought, whatever this guy is doing with this protest, and by the way, email tonightwithpodcasts@gmail.com. If you're the artist, or if you know the artist, if you know what it's all about, let us know. Because I'm very fucking confused about really what that means. Obviously they go, I don't like Trump. That's okay.
Yeah, sure.
But something about turning it into a cartoon of a cartoon of a cartoon makes me really confused.
Yeah, like talk about convolution.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Is that a word?
Yeah, absolutely. It is convoluted. Yeah, that's exactly what you're doing. You're diluting it, you're convoluting it. It doesn't make sense anymore. So I'm wondering why that person thinks that their image is in some way waking us up to something that we just don't already know.
I know. That's what gets me about the fight the man system style stuff.
Yeah.
I'm with you. Like, let's fight the man. Fight the man. I'll fucking fight the man.
Let's go and fight him.
We can't fight the man with when we draw pictures of Trump as pigs with
I saw a bit of paper that had clearly been handwritten that was pasted or taped to a battery box, or whatever those boxes are on the street, like a phone wiring box. It was just a bit of paper, and it had handwritten on it, like, don't believe the government, don't believe what they tell you, look out for the disaster artists, look out for this kind of stuff. Now, the fact that has just been handwritten and taped onto a bit of a box, I believe that way more.
100%.
If you fucking recreate a cartoon of Donald Trump as a pig and then you paste it everywhere, I just think you're an arsehole.
Yeah, you're essentially turning things into a brand.
You're a bit of a Trump yourself, mate. You know what I mean? You're doing what they're doing.
Yeah.
I don't like that.
Is that a fight fire with fire attitude? And if it is,
I think it's a fight stickers with stickers, and it doesn't make any fucking sense.
Let's all hang around in a bizarrely primordial broth.
Let's imagine a British person who believes in Donald Trump. I mean, they must be rare, but those that do exist, they see that image that goes liar liar with a pig Trump in the middle of it with a banner in the middle, and they go, you know what? Maybe he is. You know,
maybe he is the bee's knees.
Actually, no. Maybe he is a liar.
I don't think so. I think that when you advertise,
I think they're trying to make
like
life into a comic book. They're trying to make it into a comic book.
I think you're right.
Yeah. And I don't think that's right. I think that's really weird. Like they're not. It's not a comic book. That guy is comical. He is a cartoon, a physical, fleshy, rotund cartoon.
Just a pig. You'd have to make him a pig to make him look
more ridiculous. He already looks fucking ridiculous.
This is what annoys me about this stuff annoys me a lot, man. Like you know, if you think someone's a pig, to draw them as a pig.
Liar, liar, as if Donald Trump would tell the truth. What the fuck does that mean?
When did anyone think that Donald Trump was ever going to tell the truth?
It wasn't.
Ever.
It wasn't even on the cards. He was voting into power, and then people were like, well, you know, maybe we're going to get some real insight from this guy.
Maybe be the honest man we all know you to be. Trump Tower.
Yeah, what the fuck?
Like, when did you ever expect him to not be a liar?
I think what actually happened.
I get that. I totally get that.
And this is why I'd be interested in hearing the artist.
But also, like, just the idea of turning someone into a cartoon. Like, if you, like, just the idea of turning Trump into a cartoon.
It's stupid.
Yeah, because he is a everyone knows that.
Yeah, it's totally ridiculous. But I think on another level, I kind of get you know, like someone just trying to make a political point. And they want to do it through art. I get that totally. You know, and they're trying to make a protest poster. I totally understand that. But saying someone who is naturally born to be a liar and calling them a liar is like calling. I mean, it just doesn't make sense. It's like
my problem is I always question leaders of.
Anything.
Yeah.
If you're a leader of Tesco, you're probably slightly corrupt.
Like if you're the leader of an underground revolutionary group,
yeah.
You're probably a complete maniac. Like
totally.
Like that's how
I think anything. If anything, we could learn from the whole Trump thing is that if you can elect someone who is so crazy and so fucking stupid, it goes to show you can elect anyone. But to just call them crazy, to call them stupid, it's just like saying a burger is this burger. It doesn't make fucking sense.
Yeah, that's exactly what it's like. Yeah,
you know. And if they're trying to get through to anyone who might not have known it already, that's the wrong approach.
Yeah, yeah. Like you say earlier, you catch more bees with honey.
Absolutely,
flies.
Although you probably would with bees as well. But I think as well that with Trump supporters or anyone in the UK who supports Trump, if they already didn't care about him grabbing women by the pussy,
I know.
If they already didn't care about the fact that he was saying weird incestuous stuff about his daughter.
If they
didn't care about the fact that he was shaking hands with North Korea, if they didn't already care about the fact that he was having secret conversations with guys in Russia and fucking people who work for Vladimir Putin. If they didn't care about any of that stuff, this tiny cartoon where they make him out to be a pig is not going to work.
It's mental, isn't it?
It's mental. It shows to me a level of dissociation between the artist and what he's making.
But now, what are you doing?
So why don't they just draw a... And I can see by the image that artist who made the Trump image, they clearly knew how to draw a pig.
Oh, man.
Why doesn't that artist just make some cool images of pigs and they put them up on walls... That'd be way cooler.
Way better.
You know, just paste up some pigs, man. Like, let's not fuck around with trying to make this a political statement. If you're a good artist, you want to put them out there, put your fucking pig drawings up.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you, man. I'm sort of succumbed to the bevies here, but I also believe that. I'd rather see good images of pigs than I would rather see boring parodies of a boring president.
Absolutely, that's a concise statement. But what one thing I'll also say as well is, having studied conceptual art, all I can say is that art that involves politics directly, and I mean directly in terms of like it's Tony Blair, Tony Liar. That's actually unfortunately something from fucking 12 Monkeys, goddamn, you know. Bloody the director who did fucking I'm so drunk now I can't fucking remember anyone's fucking name. Terry fucking Gilliam, thank God my brain. Terry Gilliam in his movie which is an awful film, God damn it. The last film of Heath Ledger. It's called The Imaginarium of Dr. Parnassus.
Yeah, yeah.
The only good thing about this film is that you see Heath Ledger walk into home base. I never thought that moment would come.
No, that's unbelievable.
I've never seen anyone in a film walk into home base. I never expected that Heath Ledger would walk into home base wearing a plague doctor mask. I mean, that's fucking brilliant. And I give him props for that, but the rest of the film is awful. It's so bad. And the main character's name is like Tony Liar or something, or Tony something, and all the papers are like, Tony Liar, Tony this and that. It's like, it's just so fucking on the nose. It's so obvious. I fucking hate it.
No.
It's like, why can't you be a little more subtle about what you're trying to say? You know, but this is it. I think art, just like I always say...
Tony Blair's a war criminal.
Absolutely, I know that. You don't have to say, like, George Gush to say fucking George Bush. You know, it doesn't... You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do.
But what I'm trying to say is, I think my art, just like my vegetables, I like my broccoli over here, I like my chicken over there. You know, I like to eat them separately, sometimes I eat them at the same time, but I choose when I want to do that. I don't like my art to be this fusion of politics and other things, because if we look at...
I fucking totally get that, like, I'm exactly like that, I don't, like,
I may be personally sort of like a semi-political abhorrent being. I get my own. I know what.
I think you're more political than me.
Maybe, but I know what sort of like I know the things I think about, and I know the sort of the frameworks. I feel like I know the frameworks that I'm talking about when I talk about them, but I certainly don't want that mixed up with
your songwriting.
I don't want that mixed up. Well, certainly not my songwriting.
All the best, but all the songs you've written have things to say about the human soul. And I think that's brilliant.
If we make art, it's about
leaders and governmental bastards.
Yeah.
And we still try to make it have something to do with the human soul.
Politicize.
We're basically, all we're doing is we're falling into the trap that they've made.
Exactly.
They've laid out a bear trap in the forest.
We need to dance.
Dance, yeah. Between.
Well, I mean, that's a full stop.
Let's imagine. I like this forest analogy though. Let's imagine the forest itself is the beauty of art. Yeah,
right.
You've got these wonderful trees that we can't explain. You've got all these leaves and this experience of being in the forest. If you ever been in the forest on your own, just go.
Have you ever seen what lives beneath the foliage?
Yeah.
On the bottom.
Everything
underneath the dried leaves.
Yeah.
Like that. I mean, we're talking about insane communities, like super, super civilized. Way different. Like, I
what's
mean,
more important?
You know, the world. The world of human is like, and then just under one leaf in a forest that hasn't been seen for a while. Just everything
so
underneath.
Here's my rhetorical question for you. Not to say that you can't answer it, but I'm deliberately being a dick. Is what is underneath the leaves less or more important than what's going on with Donald Trump's haircut?
Yes, that's a great question.
I think the answer is Donald Trump means nothing on the mystical level of things, and if art is not even attempting to approach mysticism, then it shouldn't exist.
I think we were talking earlier. Right now, all I can think about is moist moss.
Moist moss,
clinging to the trunk of a at the bottom of a tree.
Yeah.
But this moist moss is like the outskirts of a canyon that belittles the foliage beneath it, the decaying.
Hello. Cheers.
Yes, man. Yes.
Cheers.
Yes.
So now we're at the Hare and Hounds.
Now we're at the Hare and Hounds. Yeah.
It used to be the fire hydrant, right?
I don't know.
Yeah, I think it used to be. That goes to show more of an old school Brightonian.
Across the road from the fire station. Yeah.
Must be there, and also next to Duke of York's.
I'm not an old school Brightonian.
I used to only drink at the Duke of York's because it was the one pub that wouldn't ID me.
I belong to one town, man.
True.
That's Yeovil.
Of course. The what?
Yeovil.
The Oval?
Yeovil.
Yeovil. What's that?
I saw the Blue Tones there once.
Oh, right, okay, cool. Is that in Cornwall?
No, I don't think so. I think it's in Gloucester. It's a spiritual home of mine.
Nice, beautiful. Well, what we're going to do is just explain, because we don't know how much of the last bit of the podcast, the last pub, which was the Shakespeare's Head.
Yes, that's what we're
saying.
We don't know
how much of that was recorded and what wasn't. So what you'll probably hear is the beginning of something and then cut short in the middle.
Yeah.
We were talking about art, politics. We were essentially saying, should politics be involved in artwork? Should not be. The consensus we got to is absolutely fucking not.
Absolutely, definitely not.
And that the
100%. If you think it should be, then you, Chris Martin, and Bono can just have a sort of
weird orgy in the hills.
Some sort of Bermuda Triangle of a wankathon.
Absolutely, yeah.
Lost to everyone, hopefully.
I feel that the mysticism, which is inherent within the best artwork,
the finest paintings, the most brilliant performances, the best films, has nothing to do inherently with specific, time-specific politics. You know, it might have something to do with politics on a broader level, but nothing specific.
That's right, yeah. And I don't think I like my broccoli so close to my steaks.
No, there you go. And I feel the same. Now, let's talk about this pub. We're in the Hare and Hounds. We've been here.
Right, okay.
We've been here probably a million times, right?
Yeah. I've been here a thousand times.
I don't know if
I've been here a thousand times.
I reckon I've probably been here about verging on maybe about 60. Sorry, I'm mashing my moustache
together. Just stating.
I think I've been here about maybe like 50 times.
Yeah, I must have been here.
Could be 60 times.
I must have been here a lot of times too.
Funny enough, this
is a bit of a bullshit pub. I wouldn't
it's
come
not bullshit,
and.
Is it?
Yeah, well, I'd never drink in here.
It's expensive.
I would. No, what is it?
Well, actually, this is a funny story for you listeners, is that we actually managed to use the same discount card from the Good Companions.
Yes, we did.
We managed to use it here. I had no idea we could do that, but it goes to prove that it's the same brewery, and also the bar staff are clearly, they got their head on their shoulders and what's going on.
Because they're not, when I said, Lanes, and he went, no, we're not Lanes.
Yeah, so they won't do Lanes discount, but they will do
which
car
we got
discount.
In the last one, but they'll do Good Companion style discount.
Fucking mad, absolute mad.
So, pretty good price?
Yeah, it was
380 a pint.
Well, that's fucking amazing. Out of this world.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Well, considering two of the points tonight have been 490.
Yeah, that's amazing. That is really good. But I will say this, like, I haven't come in this pub for at least 2 years.
Really? Yeah. It's been less time for me, I think, but I can't quite.
Okay.
I think the last time I was here.
Okay, when was the last time you had a good time in this?
I think the last time I was here was when the Chosen was here, when they had the restaurant and the kitchen.
Then we really are talking about 2 years.
Oh, no shit, no, I came here after that.
But when it had, like, the blind pig or something like
that.
The smoky pig.
The smoky pig.
The smoky pig face, yeah.
Yeah. Perhaps the same artist as those Donald Trump.
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
But yeah, but I remember, and it wasn't so good. The food was shit.
Yeah, the place is awful. Like, it's like the pub itself.
How do you describe it?
The pub itself looks fucking beautiful. It's got like this kind of a slightly industrial sort of like Meccano ceiling going on over the top.
That's a great description, Meccano ceiling.
Yeah, and then it's got like nice brickwork inside, which is great. The bar is an island, so you can order a drink from any part of it. It's quite cool. In essence, it should be fantastic.
Yeah.
But it seems
you're saying that some of the parts they don't add up to anything.
I'm saying that unlike the Meccano kind of ideal that it's giving off, things don't fit together in this place.
You'd think from a pub called the Hare and Hounds that you'd find something that was a lot more ELD pubby. But I think what this pub is trying to do is it's trying to be one of the kind of pub/club.
Yeah, it's slick.
Environments.
It's giving it a slick. Well, it can't be a slick. Not when the garden is closed.
Yeah, exactly.
And what are we on? We're on 11 o'clock?
Yeah, exactly.
We're 11:10 and the garden's closed.
Yeah, so it's not.
Which
quite
might be
closed.
Normal, but not for a real good boozer.
Yeah, exactly.
So what we are doing is there's a brilliant little bit of booths down there, and they're all like sort of red, and they've got a kind of geometric pattern.
Yeah, I mean, in a way, it's kind of like a sexy version of what the Brewdog pub wants to be.
Yeah, no, you're right there.
More comfortable.
Yeah, it's way more
spacious
comfortable
version.
Than that. Yeah, yeah.
You know,
no, you're right.
We haven't gone to Brewdog yet within the podcast, but it's kind of a pub full of cages. It kind of tries to make you feel like spending £10 on a pint is rational.
Yeah. There's bits of red here. There's bits of light. I like the place. I don't like the metal seats. I think.
Yeah.
Like we're sat.
One of the cool things here, I don't know if they still do it, but they used to do a video game night here where they put on like all the different like PlayStations, N64s and shit with like huge projection screens and stuff. And I've never known
you know, I walked into a charity shop on Western Road the other day and they had a Mega Drive just set up in the back.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I walked in.
They're selling it.
I saw the Mega Drive and I thought, like, I was like fumbling over my wallet.
trying to.
Were they
yeah, no, it's not for sale written on it. But it said not for sale, free to play.
Right.
I thought you
that's kind of how I feel about myself. Not for sale, free to play.
I like that, man. And it makes me kind of sad, but I like that. I ended up playing a 1993 NHL National Hot League of Hockey.
Shit, that might be the same game they play in the movie fucking Swingers. Do you remember the movie Swingers?
I know exactly what we're talking about.
There's that scene where the pizza guy comes by and he's like,
game.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. So I was hammering that game out. Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. I always wanted to play that. Really good fun.
Really good fun.
That's good times.
In fact, they were selling the game. It's weird, isn't it?
You know, sometimes I go into game shops and I just look at games and I don't buy them.
Well, because you like that stuff.
You know, there's a part of my heart now that, like, I waste a lot of time. But I have to specifically know why I'm wasting that time before I do it. See, as a child, as a teenager, I never thought that way. I could just waste time freely and enjoy it. But now, before I waste time, I have to have a purpose for why I'm doing it, which is perhaps why we're doing this entire podcast.
Yeah, possibly.
I have to have a specific reason. And so it's quite... I find it difficult for me playing games, but I dream of games. I think about playing them all the time, but it's a different thing. But in terms of this pub, what I do miss is sitting in that garden. I wish we could sit in that garden right now.
It's a good garden to sit in.
It's alright, isn't it? It's kind of sad that we're not there. But I think we'll go up for a cigarette out the front and reminisce about that.
Yeah.
But I think as a good boy to
our listeners... Well, right now, I'm going to go let's go for a smoke. I don't think we should say goodbye yet.
Oh, we're not saying goodbye. All right, fair enough. Well, to all those dear listeners who are still here, we will come back. We'll see you in a minute.
Right on.
Here we are. We've returned. We've returned from the smoko. So leave me alone.
Exactly. Yeah.
We were outside. We were talking about how perhaps the Australian punk scene has a lot more to say about contemporary music,
and a lot more to say about contemporary Australia.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. You know what I found out though? I was reading an interview with Amel and the Sniffers, who we're going to see on Sunday.
Yeah, fantastic, man.
Yeah, I can't wait to see him. And I was just reading this interview, and this British interviewer said, what do you like the most about Brighton in the UK? And they said that how cheap the pints are, because a pint here is the equivalent of $8 in Australia.
Fuck me.
So a five pound pint is $8 in Australia, right?
Jesus, alright.
But most pints in Australia are $12.
Fuck me.
I know. For a country which is,
I tell you what though, most people get paid there, like their minimum wage is like $22.
An hour.
Yeah. So like it's relevant. So it's like what I was talking about this to Alice earlier, and I was saying, look, if I can get paid to write, like, you know, like you do, like if I can set up a system where people are on the longevity and constantly paying me to write stuff, then like sure, in England I only make, hey, whatever, $800 to $1,000 a month. But if I take that wage and I move it to Bulgaria, man, that's fucking next level. Australia, what I'm saying is Australia over there, they're getting this $22 an hour shit, and then they're going, oh man, $12 a pint, this is bullshit, which is about right. You make about £9 an hour and a pint is about $4.50-ish.
When we were at the beginning of
the Sniffers, they take that Australian dollar, come over to England, and they're like, fucking let's drink, man. Like,
sure, yeah.
It's like going to Prague for us.
Yeah, sure, yeah, I believe that. When we were talking about James...
Imagine them in Prague.
Yeah, I mean, this was a year ago that the interview I was reading, and they were talking about how excited they were to go to Germany, because they knew loads of German people liked them. You know? It was the first
really
non-English-speaking country.
That's really cool.
Yeah. I mean, now they're even bigger, right?
They're massive now. Yeah.
Wasn't to say they were.
Well, they are pretty massive in that scene. Yeah, they're pretty massive.
But James Meaden, who we referenced earlier, the Diamond Geezer, Brad Pitt. I think we referenced him in the first pub we were in. He went to Bulgaria with the idea that like any money he would earn would be worth like five times as much.
Right.
And they ended up moving from there because Budapest was where. Wait, is Budapest Bulgaria? Is that?
No, I don't think so. But I think Budapest is Budapest.
Sorry, I think I fucked things up.
Hungary.
It's not Bulgaria I'm talking about. It's Budapest.
I was talking about Bulgaria.
Fair enough. But he said the same thing to me. He said the same thing about Thailand as well.
Yeah.
He said that in Thailand, everything's worth more. He talked about it in a very poetic way, as if it was going to be like super cool. But obviously, things haven't quite worked out like that. Like,
well, yeah, but because he's not making. So the difference is, he's not making money, sort of
from outside.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. So here, if I make $10 here, that's like what, £7?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
And £7 in England is like what? You know, a pint, and if you're lucky, about a basket of chips.
Maybe.
Maybe. Probably not. Probably not. But if you take £7, and you take £7 and you move them to Bulgaria, or you move that £7, actual £7, and you move that £7 to Thailand, for instance.
Sure. Yeah.
Then that £7 is like that £7 becomes more. It becomes more like 14 or 20 pounds.
Sure, okay.
So, because you can buy similar things that you buy for £7, that £7 can buy sort of twice as much. So what I'm talking about is, if you have an outsourced sort of online
thing like Fiverr, writing online.
Yeah, if you take money in, like in dollars.
Yeah.
From whoever, then so you can take that money in from dollars, and you take it. Yeah, it sounded
time
like
of the
it,
bar.
Time of the bar. But if you take that cash,
or more. Nah.
You take that cash, then you can take the money you earn here, and you can earn a certain amount of money, but it's like a bit like, oh, I'm struggling. But if you took yourself to India, Bulgaria. I mean, there's so many places in the world that you specifically, Bob, could take yourself, and you would live incredibly comfortably.
I think I'm just going to get another drink briefly.
Should
we say goodbye?
Let's say goodbye.
All right. Well, it's been lovely to be with you, listener, and I do hope you come back with us next week, where we're going to continue this pub crawl from exactly where we are right now.
Certainly will do. It's been fantastic.
Godspeed, Godspeed.
Getting a pint at the pub today, it sure does take a lot. And 900 bars at £4.50 costs a fucking lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? Sometimes you wanna drink in every pub in Brighton Town. From Wetherspoons to Jumbo Lounge. Checking the map at the dog track. From the lobster to the fucking cow. We're gonna drink in every pub in town. We're having a smoke at the County Oak. The jolly drinking a beer. The infinite crawl bring boozing to your ears.